Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
Well, I first started hearing about 1898 in 1968 when Dr. King was murdered. There were riots in Wilmington, as there were all over the country. At the time, my family was deeply involved with First Baptist Church, and immediately adjacent to the church was the Wilmington Light Infantry Building, which at the time was the New Hanover County Library. But the Wilmington Light Infantry still maintained a room in that building. And in that room was the guns they used in 1898, including the machine gun, which I used to play with when I was a kid. When I'd go to the library and there would be members of the Wilmington Light Infantry in that room or Red Shirt Militia in that room, I would go in there and listen to them talk about 1898 and how they had pulled off the coup and how they had killed hundreds and hundreds of people and how, you know, they had taken over. And the words they used was, "We put them niggers in their place."
People here, they wouldn't talk about it. You know, it was almost like post-traumatic stress or denial. No one really would talk about it. And I had an older cousin. She wouldn't talk about it. Only thing she would say was that it was not about what's been written.
What really brought 1898 out was the Wilmington 10. I don't think if it hadn't been for the Wilmington 10, it would have still been a secret. Because in researching the Wilmington 10, you bump into 1898. You have to. You have to bump into 1898. It was the civil rights issue after the assassination of Martin Luther King. Of course, after the assassination of when Martin Luther King was killed in April 1968, there was racial violence and burning and looting and rioting in over 100 cities. So when this Wilmington 10 thing came up, it was a big deal. There were high school students who were boycotting the school because they had closed down the black high school in Wilmington. And what happened was they started meeting at this church, and the Ku Klux Klan came by the church shooting at the church. At the children who were inside. These were children inside the church. And most of them left after that. Right? It was 4 days of racial violence. Two people were killed, almost $1 million worth of damage, if you count today's money. Right? But what they didn't count on was arresting Ben Chavis, who was highly intelligent, who had connections. And he started alerting all these people about what had been done. They arrested, a year after 1971, 1972, they arrested some people who later became known as the Wilmington 10. In the process, you had to look at the history of Wilmington, and when you looked at the history of Wilmington, you found out that the town is almost synonymous with racial violence.
Context of White Supremacy, Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Monday, December 21st, 2015, so I have been told. Happy birthday, Andrea. broadcast for the day before we get started. It snowed here today. It has not snowed in these parts in about 2 years since the last time I saw snow. This would be one of those, again, to say we could have been doing all kinds of other things, but instead we are here still trying to solve the problem: white supremacy, racism, white people. That said, very pleased about doing this broadcast. I think a lot of great information, particularly for folks in the North Carolina area. Founder of the Black Talk Radio Network, Scotty Reed, he's right in North Carolina, and we have quite a few other listeners who are in that area. I certainly myself spent a good deal of time in that area, so I think it's great to get more information about different parts of the world, particularly the history of white terrorism. And I think a lot of our listeners have an affinity for quality documentary films that reveal truth about racism. And I think this is at the top of the list. Fantastic film, great project, and looking forward to getting more details about it from the filmmaker. What I want people to kind of have in mind from the very beginning, I think anytime that we talk about whichever terms people want to use to describe them, these racial cleansings where large numbers of black people, where whites, racists, they come in, they terrorize the black citizens, kill, rape, just horribly abuse and assault large numbers of black people, and then give some sort of ultimatum: you have until sundown, you have 24 hours, you have 72 hours to leave town. I think people have some sort of superficial knowledge, at least they'll know the name and that something bad happened in association with Tulsa, Oklahoma, what they call Black Wall Street. Same thing with Rosewood in Florida. Those will generally be about the only two. They'll have some sort of superficial knowledge that, you know, these type of events happen in these two places. It was really really bad. Black people, you know, were doing pretty well. And then white people came and, you know, killed a lot of black people and kicked them out of the town. I think it's super, super important. Maybe one of the most critical things that I hope people keep in mind for this program and anytime any of these events are brought up in the future: these things didn't just happen once or twice. Extremely important book. Unfortunately, it is written by a white man, Buried in the Bitter Waters. Elliot Jaspin is the author. He was a guest on the program in 2010. You can go back in the archives and check out the broadcast. It should be linked in the description. But we had him on the program. He said, and this white man was a journalist, and he also did a lot of data collection. So he would go through and analyze statistics from data that he would get from the United States government. But he said, according to his analysis of U.S. Census records, and he had his own criteria for how he would determine how many racial cleansings took place. According to his estimates, there were at least, or I can't even say that because that's minimizing, there were more than 260 of these events, like what we're going to talk about today: Wilmington, North Carolina, as I said, Rosewood, Black Wall Street in Oklahoma, more than 260. And even that is a low number because according to Mr. Jaspin, his criteria was it had to be countywide. It couldn't just be a city or a town. It had to be the whole county where white terrorists came in and said, "You niggas gotta go." That was one. It had to be, the town had to remain all white. So whenever this event happened, it had to be, when he put his book, when he did this research, which was in the 2000s, the town had to still be all white. So they kicked the black people out and black people never returned to the town. He said it had to be immediate, like this wasn't something that they planned a year or 5 years in advance. It had to be something where, you know, like on Monday, they just said, "Forget it, niggas are gone." And then by Thursday, bam, they have kicked out all the black people. So he had a list of criteria that he used to determine how frequently he thought this had happened. And the number he came up with was at minimum 260 times that this happened just in this area of the world. For me, that is crucially important because these should not be looked at as isolated events. I can even hear people in North Carolina saying, "Oh man, why are you picking on us?" This happened a lot this is the way that we should frame conversations around racism, white supremacy, when we talk about it. Great films. They're fantastic films on this. We're talking about one of the best today, but other films on this, Banished, Marco Williams, he's also a black filmmaker. Great, looks at several of these events. Trouble Behind, which I think also a black filmmaker did, which talks about one of these events in Kentucky. If you all remind me, I'll play a sound clip from that later on. But today, the documentary film that we're going to be talking about, I'm just super excited, Wilmington on Fire, talking about one of these incidents that happened 1898 in the great state of North Carolina, right next door to Ben Tillman in South Carolina. We talked about some of this before. Our guest for today's broadcast, in addition to putting together this phenomenal project that we are privileged to discuss today, he is an author, director, filmmaker, and a writer. He put his immense skill to use to put this feature-length documentary together. He is a native of North Carolina. If you check out the film, he has some people we're very familiar with. Dr. Umar Johnson is in the film. William Sandy Darity, he's been on Cree's program. Great work on racism, white supremacy. Quite a few other folks that, you know, I think people would have some sort of knowledge with having seen these folks before, but just fantastic information, and we're really pleased to have him on the broadcast today. Thankful he could share a bit of his Monday evening with us. Joining us live, Mr. Christopher Everett. Mr. Everett, are you with us, sir?
Hey, How's it going, Gus?
Right, poorly, but I am just really pleased that you could share a bit of your evening with us. As I said, fantastic film, and looking forward to getting into some of the details of your just A-plus project. For listeners, this might be their first time hearing from you. Just anything that you think would be important for listeners to know about who you are and the work that you do?
Okay, well, my name is Christopher Everett. I'm a 33-year-old black male from North Carolina. You know, I have a few years of film production experience. I started off, I would say, about 2002, doing acting and modeling. You know, that's when I guess I was back in, you know, get shape and everything back in those days, man. But, you know, I started off doing acting and commercials and stuff like that. And then I say I moved to Atlanta about 2007. And that's when I kind of just made the transition of wanting to do my own projects and just kind of being in control of my own destiny and also just telling stories, you know, about our history as well, you know, as our experience also, you know. So I decided just start doing my own projects. And I did a film project, I would say, back in 2008 on the Laurinburg Institute. It's a historical black boarding and day school in my hometown of Laurinburg, North Carolina. It's been around since like 1904. And when I was filming the guy who runs the school now, his grandparents started the school in 1904. And he was just talking about when his grandparents came up from Alabama to start the school, he was just talking about just a lot of racial tension and a lot of things going on in North Carolina back in the early 1900s. So I was like, okay, well, what was going on in the state back then? And when I would do research, I kept running into the whole 1898 massacre. And right then and there, I started doing research on it, and I decided then that I wanted to do this as my first full-length project. And, you know, here we are today.
Outstanding. We will kind of go through and give some of the details of the project and how this came together. I guess first, I think we've already stated, but just for the record, you are a black male, correct?
Yes.
Right on. This program, Context of White Supremacy, I have unfortunately concluded that we are in a global system of white supremacy racism. I use those two terms as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists, and do you think that's an accurate definition?
You're right on the money in my book. I totally agree.
Right on, right on. I've been trying to ask different non-white people that come on the program down through the years, are you afraid of white people? And I thought I will ask Mr. Everett, are you afraid of white people?
No, I'm not afraid of anyone.
Right on, right on. Appreciate the honesty. You North Carolina native, how far the area where you were kind of raised at in North Carolina, how far is that from Wilmington?
It's about, like, Laurinburg, man. Laurinburg is about an hour, it's about an hour and a half from Wilmington. And Laurinburg is a real weird place, man. It's pretty much about an hour and a half from a lot of places, like an hour and a half from Wilmington, hour and a half from Charlotte, hour and a half from the Raleigh-Durham area, even an hour and a half from Columbia, South Carolina. So the way it's kind of positioned, it's real close to a lot of these, you know, major areas. I know you discussed in prior shows about Ben Tillman, you know, and his, you know, his, you know, terrorism in South Carolina as well. So, you know, people in Laurinburg, I know we studied about him in school as well because they're, like, real close. Columbia, South Carolina is real close to Laurinburg because Laurinburg is, like, right there on the South Carolina line. It's about 10 minutes from the South Carolina line, actually. But Laurinburg is about an hour and a half from Wilmington. It's real close.
Okay. My man Ben Tillman, definitely got to bring him up down the road. The threat of Negro domination hangs over us like the sword of Damocles. That is my quote for the year, one of them at least, from direct from the lips of Ben Tillman, former U.S. Senator and governor of South Carolina and long legendary white terrorist in this area of the world.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know, it seems from what you already shared, that you did not really know a whole lot about this event. Do you remember anybody talking about it when you were growing up, like your parents or people in school or other relatives?
Nah, man, because like I said, a lot of people, if you're not from Wilmington, it was kind of like a story that was kind of restricted just to Wilmington. Hmm. Like, when I talked to people, when I've interviewed people, it was just a story they might have heard from their grandparents or just people in their church. They didn't really go into depth with it, though. It was kind of like, you know, when you're sitting on a porch and talking about folklore or whatever like that. But in my hometown, Laurinburg, we heard nothing about this stuff. Even in other places like Charlotte and other areas, you know, no one really, you know, talked about it. It was kind of like a thing restricted to Wilmington. But I would say when they came out with the full report and they put together the 1898 Race Riot Commission in the early 2000s, and they finally came out with an actual full state report in 2006, that's when kind of the whole state really, really, you know, started putting it out there. You know, that's when the media started coming around. They started doing news stories. People started doing, you know, news articles and all those things. So I would say around the late 1990s, early 2000s, that's when the message kind of started spreading out about what happened in 1898.
Wow. When the idea kind of came, you said you were talking to some of these older black people, and then they were talking about some of the history, and you got interested in this project and saying, hey, I think I want to take my first feature-length film to focus on this. Did you have anybody try and say, hey, you know, come on, Mr. Everett, you should pick something else. This is, you know, contentious. You're just stirring up old trouble from way back when. Did any people try to discourage you from doing this project?
I had a few, man. Actually, my ex-girlfriend from, like, I was dating my ex-girlfriend, man, in, like, 2010 to, like, 2012. She was one of the main ones. She told me, because I think I told her when I first got the idea, and I wrote it down, I wrote, like, a full outline and everything. I was like, you know, I want to make this my first project, and I talked to her about it. And she was totally against it, man, and, you know, she really wasn't supportive at all. She was like, you know, you should make, like, some type of comedy or something like that. I was like, nah, I need to do this project, man. It just feels right to do this. And, she really wasn't supportive. She was against it. And a few other people as well that were kind of against it. But I just paid them no attention, and I just kept moving forward. And, you know, it was a long road, but we got it done. You know, but I had a few people, but the majority of people have been real supportive. I only had, like I say, a handful of people that said, hey, you know, why are you bringing up old stuff, or they're going to get you, all this stuff like that. But the majority of the people have been real supportive and have backed what I've been doing for the past few years.
Right on, right on. Hopefully the ex, when she sees the film, be like, dang, I was wrong. I should have been more supportive. This is outstanding. Okay, so I guess before we get into some of the details about exactly how this unfolds, just it seems to me at least like a lot of research went into this film on your part. Like, can you kind of give us an idea of the scope, how much time that you spent kind of going through the archives, reading reports, talking to people to be informed about this?
I would say that took like a year prior before I even started anything. I say from 2010, 2011, I got a whole bunch of books, actually printed out the full actual official report that's online now. It's like 600 pages. And I pretty much read, I'm probably like one of the only few people that's ever read the actual report. Because whenever we do a screening, we ask people, who's all read the report? And raise their hand. I'm like always the only one that raises their hand. But I read like the whole 600-page report, read a few of the books, and I actually reached out to one guy that you saw in the film. His name's Larry Thomas. And I reached out to him because when I started doing this and researching, I knew I needed people to be in the project, but I wanted to have some people that a lot of people might not have known about, and I wanted to have a good mixture of actual people who have been, you know, supporters of this movement on exposing this history. But I also wanted to get some familiar people as well. But I reached out to Larry Thomas. I Googled him, and I saw that he actually seeks out actual direct descendants of some of the victims of the massacre. He has an organization that actually does that. And so I hit him up, and, you know, we started chatting and everything like that. And then I say, about 2011, I was ready to roll to just start getting some filming done. And, you know, we just started filming him and a few of the other descendants, direct descendants. And I ran into some other people who actually done extensive research and contributed to the actual official report as well. So it pretty much was, man, doing about a year's worth of research prior to started filming. And then while I was filming, you know, I would kind of find out new things from interviewing people that I didn't think about. So when I would interview someone and they bring something new to the table, I would have to research that and find out, you know, where they got that from. Or they would assist me in the research and provide me certain documents of things they found over the years. So it was like, I would say it was a mixture of filming and research from like 2010 to 2014.
Outstanding. I think Dr. Welsing would be proud. She tells us all the time, reading is more important than watching television. And with regards to white supremacy, there is so much to read, so much to learn. Let's dig into some of that history, since you are one of the few folks who can say, hey, I have some expertise on this that most people don't have. Can you kind of give us some details so we have some historical context for what Wilmington, North Carolina looked like towards the end of the 19th century? This is roughly three decades after the end of the Civil War and kind of what I guess is termed the fusion movement that was happening that was peculiar to this area?
Yes. Well, I guess prior to the massacre of 1898, Wilmington was North Carolina's largest city back then. It wasn't Charlotte. It wasn't Raleigh. Wilmington was the place to be for a lot of people, including African Americans, because the job market was pretty good back then. It was, you know, majority of the jobs you had around North Carolina was mostly farming and things like that. Wilmington provided a better job market, especially because of the port activity that was going on in Wilmington back then. And that led to other educational opportunities and entrepreneurial opportunities, and also political opportunities as well for a lot of African Americans. So African Americans participated pretty well in the political arena throughout the city. You had a black man. I think that was over the clerks of customs in Wilmington back then. You had black police officers. We actually have a photo of one of the black police officers back then. This one guy, that was his great 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 grandfather. And he let us use an old photo of him to be in the film. But you had black police officers back then, black firemen, black postal workers. You had a lot of black men that were heavily involved in the real estate game back then as well. And you had a lot of black artisans back then, construction workers, carpenters, blacksmiths, etc. So Wilmington was pretty much called a mecca for African Americans, you know, in the 1890s, prior to the whole 1898 massacre. But a lot of that was I think, a result of the fusion movement that was going on back then. And the fusion movement was pretty much a political movement with white farmers and black Republicans kind of merging together in this thing called fusion to kind of put their people in office. And they pretty much had, a similar common goal of, you know, education and entrepreneurship and, you know, political rights and thus forth. So through that, you know, a lot of black folks held a lot of offices, not only in Wilmington, but throughout the state of North Carolina as well. So Wilmington was a pretty cool area for black people until November 10, 1898.
Mm. For listeners, I would definitely remind folks, and if you didn't hear it, I would encourage you to check it out. N.D.B. Connolly, he's a black scholar, black professor. His book, A World More Concrete, where he brings up this incident in Wilmington, as well as Carl Andrews' book, The Land Was Ours, where they go into detail talking about how this was replicated over and over again, white theft of black property, and particularly Carl Andrews' book, The Land Was Ours, because he talks about how the history of white people confiscating generally by violence, whether it's the threat of violence or they just come in and, you know, kill however many black people and tell them to get out and take the property. But this happening over and over, both of them touch on Wilmington and just the significance of waterfront property, where, I mean, that's fishing, vacation spots, real estate, prime real estate often. The long history of white people coming in and stealing this kind of property from black people. Also thought it was important because you touch on this in the film that, as you just said, you had a lot of prosperous black people that were doing well, had property, vehicles, even servants in some cases where they were doing better than a lot of white people. One of those black people, Alex Manley, and I think you have his grandson in the film talking about all this. Can you kind of talk about who Alex Manley was? Black journalism, the importance of black journalism. Can you talk about Alex Manley?
Yeah, Alex Manley, he was, anytime you look up 1898, Google it or whatever, his name always pops up. But Alex Manley was a black man. He was a mixed race. His father was, I think was his parents' slave master. But he never really bought into the whole thing of being mixed. He always lived and said he was a black man first and foremost. He went to Hampton University and got educated and moved to Wilmington. And he started just, you know, working odd jobs like painting and stuff like that. And then he got into journalism. And him and his brother, Frank Manley, they opened up the Wilmington Daily Record. And it started off kind of like as a weekly newspaper. And they built it up and started getting advertising from white businesses and black businesses throughout the county and the city. And so they made it actual daily paper, and it was kind of considered back then one of the only black-owned daily papers in America back then. There weren't a lot, but his was one of the few back then. It was a daily paper. It was really thriving. But what really, I guess, messed him up, because his paper was one of the main papers for the Republican Party back then and the whole fusion movement back then, so he was definitely a target of the white supremacy movement. But he wrote an article. It's kind of like saying that he didn't actually write the article, but it came from his paper, so he had to take the fall for it. But a lady by the name of Rebecca Felton, she was like one of the first female senators from Georgia, and she made a speech in Tybee Island, pretty much, I think it was called Women on the Farm. And she was talking about how, you know, after slavery, these black men are out here working on a farm with white women now, and, you know, it's up to the white men to protect white womanhood because these black men are out here, you know, raping white women at will, and it's up to white men to stand up and protect white women. And Manley saw the article and pretty much wrote a rebuttal article saying that all that is false is that, you know, white men have been raping black women for years and no one is saying anything. But majority of the white women who are being sexual with black men is not being raped, it's consensual. But when white women get caught, they say it's rape. And then you want to hang black people and kill them. You know, so the white supremacists that were behind the whole 1898 massacre, they finally found something that stuck. because they were trying to plot on doing this anyway. This wasn't a spontaneous thing. They've been plotting. They were plotting for years to do the actual massacre, but they couldn't really find something that they could really stick their hands on to really promote throughout the state of North Carolina. But when that article came out, they had the ammunition to pretty much spearhead a major white supremacy propaganda campaign. So they used that article and spread it out through all of North Carolina, because the majority of the white supremacists back then owned your major media outlets, which was newspapers back then. So they spread that article and made up all these stories and just spread them out through North Carolina, which set the tone for the 1898 massacre. And one of the events, the first events of the massacre, is that white folks burned down Manley's newspaper building. And you can probably, whenever you look up 1898, you always see like a burned down building or a white mob in front of a burned down building. That's Manley's newspaper building that they burned down. Manley got out of town, I say, about 2 days prior, because I think somebody took them off and said, hey, man, they about to kill you. And it was kind of easy for him to get out of the city and the state because he could actually pass for white. Like I said, he was mixed. And he could actually pass for white. So he kind of used that, I guess, passing, you know, as a white guy to his advantage to get out of Dodge and, you know, to save his own life, actually. But Manley's business and his life was almost taken, you know, because of the 1898 massacre. But his business was the first to get burned down during the 1898 massacre.
The importance of black journalism. Emphasize that consistently on the program. And I think you stress in the film that this was not just some ragtag operation that Alex Manley was operating. This was like the most popular paper in Wilmington, North Carolina, and in fact was one of the first daily black publications in the country. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Right on.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. And the thing is, man, you know, we talk about in the film that the Democratic newspaper, which is still here in Wilmington today, it's called Star News. It's still around. And the guy over the Star News, William H. Bernard, he was a part of the whole 1898 massacre. So like my man Kent says, it's kind of funny that, you know, one of the first things you do is kind of burn out your competition. You know? And it's mighty funny that that happened, that they just automatically just say, you know, we're going to burn his newspaper thing down first. You know, start it off. You know, and then you haven't had, you've had a couple of small black publications that were just weeklies, but you haven't had nothing real major like the Daily Record since 1898.
Wow.
You know, coming from black journalism perspective, you haven't had a major black media outlet in Wilmington since.
You have a phenomenal segment, just the power of the press cannot be understated throughout the history of white supremacy. Really powerful segment with Dr. Umar Johnson, where he talks about the significance of propaganda. And in addition to the brilliant things that he offers, you also have just some incredible images to show some of the cartoons of this era. I mean, they are just amazing, where one of them, it has like a map of the southeast U.S. And so you can see like Virginia and Tennessee and South Carolina. And they're like, look, black people have been totally disenfranchised and stomped out in all these other states. And here in North Carolina, it's got
and then the image of North Carolina is like a black, like a big black brute thing.
Exactly.
North Carolina.
Exactly. Yeah. Just can you talk about the white press and those type of images and what they were doing in the buildup to getting to November 10, 1898?
Yeah, like I said, man, a lot of the people that were behind the massacre, a lot of them had newspapers back then. And the crazy thing about it is that a lot of these newspapers are still around today. Like I said, the Star News in Wilmington, the Raleigh News and Observer, Josephus Daniels started at that. He was a major, he was the one that had a lot of those cartoons from his newspaper. That newspaper is still around, the Charlotte Observer, all the major newspapers that are still in North Carolina today. They were operating back then, and they were spreading these things. And they pretty much used those cartoons, man, just to add the fuel to the fire, because a lot of people don't want to admit this. A lot of white people couldn't read back then, you know, and they knew that. And they used the cartoons to their advantage. So you can just make up a fake headline and put a cartoon of a black person doing something, or they would make up things like saying, a black man robbed a white woman last night, which really didn't happen. And Josephus Daniels and a lot of these people who actually had these newspapers, they admitted later in life that they lied a lot of these times. But, you know, it was just about selling some papers and promoting white supremacy. So they accomplished two goals at once, promoting white supremacy and getting paid. So, you know what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, they, you know, they didn't care because they knew nothing would happen. And plus, they're going to get paid as well at the same time. It's just like it's the same thing that happens today, man, when you see these crazy articles or crazy stories or the propaganda that's always promoted. You know, these news outlets are getting paid by it, but they're also spreading white supremacy at the same time. It's the exact same thing they did back then during the Wilmington massacre. The exact same thing.
Absolutely. Hugely important, the press, the power of the press. I definitely had to rewind because this incident, what happened in Wilmington, it is mentioned in the biography that we read on Ben Tillman. Ben Tillman and the Reconstruction of White Supremacy is right next door, and he did play a small role in all of this evolving. This is on 256 of Mr. Kantrowitz's book, which was in our book club from this past summer, the subsection, The White Savage. He writes, although Tillman's own pistol-bearing days were over, he continued to be associated directly with acts of violence, especially against black Southerners who remained politically active. He played an especially important symbolic role in the 1898 campaign against North Carolina's populist Republican fusion government. In 1894, an alliance between mainly white populists and the black and white wings of North Carolina's Republican Party had reversed the Redeemer's victory and inaugurated a biracial government that won further victories in 1896. In 1898, the State Democratic Party organized a white supremacy campaign attempting to use political violence and intimidation justified by white men's racial and gender anxieties to destroy the fusion coalition. I'm skipping down a little bit. It says, Tillman came to the North Carolina, to the state of North Carolina's Democratic Party to their aid. During the late fall of 1898, in speeches at Fayetteville, Red Springs, and elsewhere in southern North Carolina, he opposed populists, Republicans, and biracial coalition politics and lauded the shotgun policy. A decade later, Tillman gave a concise summary of his perspective on North Carolina in 1898. This is all in quotes directly from his lips. Negroes and mountaineers and ultra-cranky populists beat the white people who own practically all the property, pay all the taxes, have nearly all of the intelligence and integrity and character, and they held the state for 4 years. Then the banner of white supremacy was thrown to the breeze. The cry was made, rally to your colors. Be a white man or be a nigger. You have got to take a choice. And I will stop right there. He goes on to brag about their own history of terrorizing black people in South Carolina and telling white people in North Carolina that you should do the same thing and get white supremacy back on track here in the great state of North Carolina. I think it's super important. Number one, Ben Tillman is not just doing this as some crazy, toothless white person. This, at the time, he was a United States senator, former governor in South Carolina. Yep. You in the film make sure to include and emphasize that the Democratic Party in North Carolina, that they organized the White Government Alliance. That was their organization that was kind of spearheading this effort. Can you talk about that?
Yes. Let me add another thing with Ben Tillman as well, real quick. Also, it's another quote I didn't get to put in the film, but he actually, you know, he made a comment about Alex Manley as well, because he would come to North Carolina a lot, like you said. He would make speeches throughout North Carolina back in 1898, and he made a comment about Alex Manley. He said that nigga editor, Alex Manley, was in South Carolina making that type of statement about our women, we would have hung his ass a long time ago. You know, so, yeah, I got to find it. I got to find the exact quote. I'm paraphrasing, but he said something similar to that. When I find it, I'll send it to you. But, yeah, man, I was like, wow. But, yeah, he said they would have hung his ass a long time ago. Wow. If he would have made a statement down in South Carolina. So he was really up there, man, in North Carolina, really, I guess, helping the Democratic Party with their movement of white terrorism. You know, because like I said, this thing wasn't just restricted for Wilmington. This was the whole state. This was a statewide movement. They just did the actual massacre in Wilmington, but they terrorized black folks throughout the state of North Carolina. But to your question, they created a like a political movement called the White Government Union. And the guy we have in the film, Kit Chatfield, he's spent years and years, this is his specialty, research on this topic of the White Government Union. And it was pretty much like what Ben Tillman was talking about. Let's go ahead and kill this fusion movement and bring those white men from the fusion movement back to the Democratic Party, pretty much back to white supremacy. That's what it pretty much was. Let's break up this biracial, you know, coalition stuff and bring those white men back over here, because let's fully practice white supremacy and fully dominate black folks. That was pretty much the main thing of the White Government Union. And it wasn't just to Wilmington, it was all over the state of North Carolina. And you saw in the film, we actually got the documents. We got their constitution and bylaws and everything. And that's why I really wanted to do this film this way, because everything that we talk about, I wanted to make sure we got full documentation and facts and things to back up everything. So this was a very, very organized thing, man. For years, the 1898 massacre was kind of, they always called it a race riot, meaning that it was just something that spontaneously happened, which wasn't true at all. This is a well-thought-out strategy of white supremacy.
Excellent point, and I can only add, multiply that by minimum 260 times. Minimum,
yeah.
260 times throughout the U.S. I want to play a clip from the film that kind of gives some of the detail of how things unfolded on November 10, 1898, and then get your response. Just outstanding segment. I believe in this portion of the clip we'll hear Dr. Sandy Darity, William Darity. He's a professor down at Duke University, a white woman who was a part of the project. The General Assembly convened in the early 2000s to kind of issue the official statement on what happened and all the research. I think it's, is it Larae Umfleet? Is that how you say her name?
Yes. She's the one who actually did the actual official North Carolina State report. Yeah.
Okay. That's her name. There are two of the folks that you'll hear in this clip given some of the detail, and then we'll get Mr. Everett, we'll get his response after this segment. Again, phenomenal documentary. Folks should support, buy it. If they do a screening in your area, you should go check it out. It is phenomenal. Can't give it enough praise, but this is a segment from Wilmington on Fire where they discuss some of the details of what took place on November 10, 1898.
In other places where people think coup d'etats have happened, there have been temporary solutions and they were overthrown. It was permanent in Wilmington. It's the only coup d'etat in the state of North Carolina and the nation that was successful.
You had armed bands of whites who were roaming the city and essentially indiscriminately killing black people. Among these was the father of William Rand Keenan, Buck Keenan, who I think was on the back of a cart with a prototype Gatling gun and doing the same thing that I just described. So it was really, effectively, it was a slaughter. There's a substantial controversy over how many people were actually killed. I believe that the state's official report on the Wilmington riot, which I think is actually a fairly well done report, says something to the effect that the maximum estimates are in the vicinity of about 60 folks who were killed. But if you read the report and go through it page by page and count up the number of individuals who are reported to have been killed in the pages of the report, I think you get a figure that's in excess of 100 people. I have no idea what the exact number is. But the stories have it that some bodies were literally thrown into the Cape Fear River. But there was sort of almost a genocidal execution of black folks that was taking place in the city. And many people fled to the surrounding wooded areas and had to stay there until white tempers had subsided.
Reverend Crook was a target of the white supremacy group. They wanted him. They wanted him bad. They wanted him dead. So bad to the point, they thought he was actually doing a funeral here. And they were waiting, the white ministers were waiting outside the church with guns to kill him. Now, how in the world you gonna wait outside a church with guns to kill somebody and kill another minister? You supposed to be a minister. Make me wonder what type of religion that you really follow. It's not true Christianity. It's your version of white supremacy Christianity. And you're going to wait for the man. You don't think he's doing it. No regards for the dead. That's just the regards they have for African-American people. But he stood, Reverend Kirk preached in his very pulpit to these very pews. And they wait outside his very church to kill him. But he escaped for his life. And his wife had to run into the cemeteries. And it was a very horrific event. And I'm glad that he was able to write about it. Because had he not written about it, that would have been another phase in history lost.
Context of white supremacy, the religion of white supremacy. And just, I'll have to save it for later. Mr. Everett, your thoughts on that segment of your just outstanding film?
Well, yeah, man, it was a powerful segment, man. And that's another thing, too. That it was a mixture of folks that were involved in this thing. You had people in the legislature. They were behind it, the media, which was newspaper at the time, but you also had pastors like the lady Sonia Patrick in the film talked about. You had actual pastors, man, that were running around killing people at will, black folks. So, and like she said, man, you know, you're out here in front of church and you're looking to kill people, you know, and these are pastors out here. And like you said, it's, you know, white supremacy. I think Tariq Nasheed, his Hidden Colors 4 is called that, the religion of white supremacy. And I'm really looking forward to that one as well, because I think he's going to go more into depth with that, because white supremacy is a religion. So it's very funny, man, how, you know these pastors are saying they're people of God. And also one pastor made a comment, I think, after the 1898 massacre. He said that this had to happen. He pretty much said that this is the will of God, that Wilmington needs to be put back into its rightful place. You know, that black people don't need to be involved in anything. They don't need to have all this wealth and property. You know, so the massacre had to happen. It was God's will, because God has now put everything back in place. Pretty much, you know, he's pretty much put everything back, I guess, in white people's hands. That's their religion, that white people always have to be in control.
Wow. Incredible. I was going to immediately after religion of white supremacy, Professor Darity, he's talking about this prototype of a Gatling gun. And I'm sitting here before the imagery, and that's another thing. You have just incredible images, illustrations that also are in the film. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, a Gatling gun? Like, I don't know if people have seen different films, but this is one of these guns that fires like... Who knows, 80
like a machine gun.
Yeah.
Prototype for machine gun. And see, that's the thing, man, that a lot of these guys, see, a lot of these red shirts and the Wilmington Light Infantry people, militia, a lot of them were, I think, they just got back from the Spanish-American War. You know, a lot of these, it just wasn't pastors, like I said earlier, it was a mixture of people. You had your common folk, but you also had a lot of soldiers that were involved in this thing as well. And they had access to all of this military artillery, which was, one of them was the Gatling gun. Because like I said, they just came back from the Spanish-American War, and they had access to all these new prototypes, weaponry. And they used it. And it's an actual archival photo that I think we had that you played at the beginning of the broadcast, where I think Kent, he was saying that, you know, when he used to play with a machine gun when he was a kid, and they showed a picture of these guys on a wagon, and then it showed a zoom-in of the little Gatling gun. And that's what I'm saying, man. They took pictures of it and everything. And a lot of people don't realize, man, just the artillery that you had. You still had black people that tried to fight back, but they were just outarmed, man. You can't do anything with a Gatling gun, and all you got is just like a little pistol, a little, you know, shotgun thing. You know what I'm saying? You can't do anything with that. So they were just, you know, just outmanned and just outarmed, you know, with just that onslaught of white supremacy, terrorism.
I want people to put... Okay. In context, the technology of white terrorism that was used to commit just savage violence against black people. To put that in context, when they use deceptive terms to say that, oh, there was, you know, an unfortunate event in 1898, or there was a race riot, there was some sort of racial con, like, no, this is totally lopsided. This is just a total slaughter. And yes, you did have black people who fought back, and that's always been the case. I try to emphasize that as well. But I mean, you have a rifle, and I mean, this is 1898, so it's not like you have the firearm technology we have now, but you have, you know, your little rifle or pistol or whatever you have. And even, I think you include in the film, that they made it difficult for black people to even access firearms at this period of time. Yeah. You even had laws in some areas of the country where black people were forbidden from purchasing firearms. And they're coming in with prototype Gatling guns and just gun them all down. Any black person. I mean, just to put that.
Yeah, and they're also trained military as well.
Exactly. And you have that in the film as well, where you have people that were former generals in the Civil War and other conflicts, where they had expertise, they had military training, they understood military science, where they're going in and seriously organizing to kill black people and run them out of town. I mean, it is just incredible. And I also think it's super important, because a lot of times when I do hear people talk about these types of events, they will try and pass it off and say, well, these were just the illiterate, uneducated, uncouth, stupid white people. You know, these were just low class, no count whites, and the good, respectable, powerful white people. They were not involved. That is not the case here. Is that correct, Mr. Everett?
Oh, yeah, it's not the case at all. Like I said, man, this is pretty much every white person you can imagine, from the illiterate all the way up to like a congressperson. And everything in between. You had military, you had illiterate white folks, you had poor ones, you had military people, you had business owners, preachers, lawyers, all of that, all the way up to people that were actually in political office. The Wilmington Massacre, man, it pretty much utilized every type of white person you can imagine to pull this stuff off.
Wow. Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest filmmaker, Mr. Christopher Everett. Some of the major white people that were kind of involved coordinating things in this attack, I think you already laid out that one of the first acts they go to Alexander Manley, they go and they burn down where his newspaper is being published at. They're looking to kill him. I'm in agreement there. I think they were probably going to kill him, but he got out of town, so they just burn it down. They pose and do the standard for pretty much every lynching photograph that I've ever seen, where you have a just mob of white terrorists. They're smiling, proud of their act. You even see the little white children who have come out to stand by the burning fire. And even with that, you have where the black firefighters, they come in to try to put the fire out, and the whites will not allow them to come in and put the fire out. Is that correct?
Exactly. They wouldn't allow them to go in there until the actual building was fully burnt down.
I went through, because you also, in addition to being able to see the film, you were gracious enough to send me some of the links so I could read some of the reports that they had that was issued from the state of North Carolina. I just wanted to read a quick passage from there, because they talk about this rapid fire guns, the Gatling gun prototype that was used. This is from Chapter 5, and people can download this report. I can put it on Facebook or what have you, so you can go through it. You can read if you want to get more information. I would say if you are a black person and you are a resident in North Carolina, this should be like required reading. This is another one. I'd say like we should be experts. If you're a black person in North Carolina, you should be an expert on this topic. Anytime it's mentioned, oh, yeah, I saw Mr. Everett's film. I did the reading, boom, boom, boom. Well, you can rattle that off, you know, in your sleep if need be. But they write in the report, the rapid fire guns were used to intimidate men on the streets and to force compliance of African-American churches. Churches at the heart of the black community helped communicate information and were seen as an organizational threat to whites. Rumors heard by leaders of the WLI held that churches were used as arsenals ready to equip black men with weapons to return fire at the whites. Therefore, at an early stage, the machine guns targeted all the churches and forced ministers to open their doors to searches by whites. at St. Stephen's AME Church on the corner of 5th and Red Cross Streets, one of the largest churches in the city with a congregation nearing 1,600 members. The crew aimed the rapid-fire gun at the church's main entrance and threatened to open fire. The church leaders opened the church, and after a thorough search, no guns were found. John Metz recalled that the WLI, which is the Wilmington Light Infantry, and the Naval Reserves were searching the churches for guns, but the only items they found were large numbers of election flyers encouraging members to vote for Dockery. Any thoughts you want to get in on that segment?
No, he pretty much explained it. You know, it pretty much talks about, you know, what the lady was talking about in the film, man. You know, just using, you know, just this intimidation, you know, of white supremacy, you know, with the power of the gun. And like you said, with the Gatling gun, man, really just going around and just terrorizing people, you know. And it was just like I said, black folks weren't doing anything wrong. They were just voting and just trying to just live their lives. But they just used every excuse to harm them, you know. So it's pretty much self-explanatory what you just read.
Right on. Echoes of Dylan Storm Roof, in my opinion. I also thought it was fantastic. You mentioned in the film Reverend J. Allen Kirk, and he was in the audio segment that we just played. He was one of the black people, one of the victims at this, where he had a church in Wilmington, North Carolina, and he actually wrote to give his thoughts about what happened during this event. Has what he wrote, has that been preserved? Were you able to kind of check out what he had to say?
Yes. Yes, and you probably saw in the film, we actually put the cover of it, and you can get that. You can check it out. It's online for free at UNCW, and I'll send you a link to that if you want to post it up later on in the group. But, yeah, his document, it's like I think a five-page document. About what happened, his account of what happened during the 1898 massacre. But like I said, man, they targeted people like the pastors and other civic leaders because, you know, the black church back then, that was kind of like the leadership in our communities back then. So they really targeted them. They targeted people like Alex Manley and other business owners and pastors as well in our communities. But Reverend Kirk, he was really vocal back then in regards to the black, you know, experience. And our rights and everything. And he actually helped Alex Manley start a newspaper as well. A lot of people don't know about that. He actually gave Alex Manley some of the startup funds to take his newspaper to the next level, you know, to make it a daily paper. So he was very active in that. And, you know, you can kind of see why he was a target as well, because he actually assisted Manley in helping to promote and expand the black voice in Wilmington. So they targeted him, man, and a lot of people. But Reverend Kirk, he has his document out there. It's at UNC Chapel Hill. And like I said, I'll send you the link to it, and you can just post it later. But him and a few other people have kind of documents about this. And this is the fascinating thing about this whole thing, is that when I started researching, I found out that a lot of white folks back then, they preserved this history. But they kind of worded it in a different way, meaning that their whole thing was that black people, you know, were doing all this crooked stuff, and white people had to rise up and just take control of the city of Wilmington and the state of North Carolina. But when you hear the black side of it, a lot of them didn't really talk about it a lot. Like I said, we have some of the descendants in my film, and they didn't, like Manley's grandson, he didn't really find out what happened to his grandfather until he got got in his, I think, 50s, 40s or 50s. You know, yeah, because he said he knew that his grandfather had a newspaper in Wilmington back then, but he didn't know why they had to move. He just thought that, okay, the business had to close down or something. You know what I'm saying? He didn't know that what happened in 1898, you know, until later down the road. And I think his father, his actual father didn't know until, like, he was like an old man. I think his grandmother wrote a letter, you know, telling, you know, his father and his uncles and them about why they actually had to leave North Carolina. And she mentions in the letter, which is still preserved in a few museums in North Carolina today, and she talks about how, you know, the massacre happened and, you know, him and their father, they had to move to Philadelphia and all this stuff that was going on. So, and that's what I've noticed, man, from the black side of this thing, that they really didn't talk about it. You know, they kind of just kept it hidden, and, you know, you're not supposed to talk about it. But I noticed on the white side, if you're like a native of Wilmington and you have strong history here from the white side, they all know about it. And they talk about it freely through their own institutions, like the churches and their little social and community groups. But the black side, they really talked about it back then.
That is an unfortunate pattern that needs to change, and I think your documentary film, fantastic effort in correcting that error in terms of us not passing this information on and talking about these events that are important, and really it's just an indictment of racists, what white people have done to us. How many people, just based on your research, how many black people do you think could have been killed in all of this?
It's hard to say, man, because they didn't really keep a total count like that. I'm thinking that it had to be in the thousands, because when you look at the population, I guess like in a year's time or 2 years' time, like the black population was cut, I say, in like half in like a year's time, you know. So I know a majority of those people, you know, majority of them were exiled, but I know a whole bunch had to be killed, because there's always been stories. Even Kent Chatfield in the film, he talks about it, how he heard with these older people, they would brag about it, talking about how, you know, they, you know, carried cartloads of black bodies and threw them in the Cape Fear River. That's always been a story from a lot of people from both sides, the white side and the black side. But you had other people say, oh, no, that didn't happen. Because when you look at a lot of the old newspapers, some newspapers say that it was only 4 people killed or 6 people killed. But when you look at the newspaper sources coming from, it's coming from the people who were actually behind the massacre. Like I said, they had all control of the newspapers back then. So they kind of controlled the narrative as well. Because even though they would put, like, it was 6 people killed, they also would put that, well, a black person started it. And you see that in a few other of the newspaper articles saying that a black person had a gun and he shot at a white person. And that's what started the massacre. And like I said earlier, they controlled the newspapers back then. And that was one of the reasons why I think they burnt Manley's newspaper down, because they had to attack one of the main sources of information back then. And that's one of the reasons why I think they burnt his newspaper press down, so he really couldn't get out the real story, the real deal of what was going on. But I'm thinking that, man, this had to be in the thousands, because you had thousands of people that were exiled, but the population change was too drastic, you know what I'm saying, for just 20 or 100 people to get killed. Because back then, Wilmington, it was a majority black city. And like I said, the population, man, got cut in half, like within a year's time.
Wow. Pattern within the system of white supremacy. If you look at a lot of these incidents, even last summer when we talked about some same thing happened in Slocum, Texas, where a lot of black people don't know about this. And then when you go and get information, the white people, same thing, justification. Well, black people were, you know, they were being criminal and raping people and blah, blah, blah. And then you try to get a toll. Well, how many black people were killed? Oh, just, you know, maybe 2 or 3. And then you go and doing the research, and author that we had on last year, he said, I think it could have been hundreds, easily, hundreds of black people. I think even Mr. Fuller said that about the Tulsa, Oklahoma incident, that it easily could have been 400, 500, who knows how many black people, because who cares? Killing a black, I think the exact words Mr. Fuller said, killing a black person like killing a roach. And I would say you can even contrast that to what happened during Hurricane Katrina, where you can't get an accurate count on how many people died exactly. It's just total lack of regard for black life.
And see, it goes back to the same thing. Who mostly controls the media outlets? You see what I'm saying? Just like back then, they controlled the media, so they can dictate the story. They can tell you, you know, especially back then, man, you know, we didn't have social media or nothing back then. So whatever was in the newspaper, that was the word, you know?
Absolutely.
You know, and that's what happened back then with a lot of these incidents. And that's why they've always been kind of hidden for so long, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. What was the role? Because I think this got a lot of attention even before the whole Charleston massacre. They were trying to get some of the statues, and I think on the campus of Duke they had a dorm or some facility that had the name of former North Carolina Governor Charles Aycock. Changed the name. What was his role in all of this and post Wilmington massacre?
Yeah. Well, remember I told you that they used every white person possible to do this thing. And I said from the illiterate white person all the way up to the legislature. He was one of the people in the legislative branch. He was like one of those guys that, see, they had all things. They said they're going to use, or they had a plan. This was part of the white government union's plan back then. They said they were going to, you know, use the poor whites to do, you know, the actual terrorism hands-on. And they're also going to use the media, which was the newspapers, to do the propaganda. And they're also going to use the legislative people, to promote and do the political, you know, promotion and stuff like that of white supremacy for the Democratic Party. And Aycock was one of those people. Not only him, but a few other political people back then as well. And their whole thing was promoting the Democratic Party back then and promoting it as the party of white supremacy back then. But the whole 1898 thing, another reason why they had to do the 1898 massacre and to cheat the election was so that they could win the General Assembly in North Carolina. And that's what they did in 1898. And once they did that, they could elect the governor. And guess who became your governor in 1900? Charles Brantley Aycock. So when they had the governorship and now they had the General Assembly, now they could implement the Jim Crow laws and they could solidify them, because you had a white supremacist governor in Charles Aycock, and you had a majority white supremacist General Assembly. So in 1900, when Aycock gets elected governor, they pretty much set up the whole Jim Crow laws of the grandfather clause. And we don't mention it in the film. We're going to mention it in the sequel. We're going to go more in depth with a lot of these laws that they created in the sequel to Wilmington on Fire. But you had this guy by the name of George Roundtree, who's, you know, who still has family here today in Wilmington. I think he has his third generation grandson, still owns and operates his great grandfather's law office, still in Wilmington today. But his great grandfather, George Roundtree, he introduces the first Jim Crow law bills, the grandfather clause, pretty much eliminating the black vote all through North Carolina. And that's what helped solidify that whole Jim Crow movement and Charles Brantley Aycock's, you know, governorship, you know, throughout the state of North Carolina. So that was Charles Brantley Aycock's role in the whole massacre thing. He was there from the giddy up of being like a legislative person going around doing speeches for the Democratic Party, but he was the guy that they made governor in 1900 to solidify the whole 1898 massacre and go ahead and put everything on the books law-wise throughout North Carolina, which created Jim Crow throughout the state.
Context of white supremacy. Can you talk about the property theft aspect of it? Like, after you've killed, you say it could have even got up over 1,000 black people and exiled thousands of black people, the theft of black land, which also involved a judicial component. Y'all have a great segment in the film talking about how the magistrates, the court clerks would come in to authorize this. Can you talk about that and how that stunted the generational transfer of wealth for black Wilmingtons?
Definitely. See, this is the thing, man. Like, some of the stuff that we talk about in the film isn't in the report, and this is one of them, because the thing is, they couldn't find a lot of the records that we found. Some of this stuff that we have in the film is new information no one's ever seen before or even, you know, heard of. But we actually found the deeds to the stolen property. We actually found the deed book that was hiding that they had. And one of these guys' records, he actually kept the deed book. The deed book is old as I don't know what. It's about, it's a deed book from like 1890, you know. And this dude had it in his records the whole time, and the state didn't find it. None of these historians found it. Me and my guy, Kent Chatfield, that's in the film, we found it, just doing some regular research. And what we found is that the guy, this guy named William Barry McCoy, who was a lawyer back then, and he was heavily involved in the Democratic Party. He had access to a lot of these records and deeds and stuff, and he actually had the deed book in his actual archives and records. And what they were doing you know, they will pretty much frame people, you know, say that, you know, we're going to charge you for a reckless eyeballing, looking at a white woman or whatever. And, you know, so back then they can charge, you know, for something like that, they can give you 20, 30 years of life pretty much for doing that as a black man. So what they would do was they would have them sign over their property, you know, so you give them their property to get out of jail pretty much a lot of times. Or they used the magistrates. They removed a lot of the magistrates and political people back then as well. And they just use racial terrorism, man, threats and everything. Get out of town, sign over your stuff, give me all your records and everything to this property so we can, you know, take it. And the thing is, people have tried to research this back in the day about the stolen property stuff and said, oh, it's a falsehood. But they were only looking at the actual the register of deeds. You're not going to find it in the register of deeds. We found it at another location, you know, where all this stuff was at. And I found that really interesting that a lot of people didn't know where this stuff was at, first of all. And it took people like me and Kent and others who really aren't, you know, we don't have these PhDs and nothing like that. And we found out what was going on, but they couldn't. I always found that very interesting. But they used these different strategies, man. It was pretty much like what they do now with the whole mortgage crisis thing, where they will foreclose on properties and stuff like that and make up names and say that, yeah, this property is in such and such name and sell it. And it was just all different type of things that were going on back then. And it was just all about money at the end of the day. And like I said, a lot of black people owned a lot of property around this place. Like one of the people we talk about in the film, Thomas C. Miller, he was one of the wealthiest black people in Wilmington back then. And I looked at some of his deed records, man. He had acres and acres of land throughout Wilmington. And he was banished from the city. He wasn't killed. He was actually banished from the city. And he became pretty much broke after that. And his family has been really affected. A lot of these families have been affected because they weren't able to pass down that generational wealth. You know, they might have moved to another city, may have got a good job. But we all know that a job really isn't wealth. You know, it's just a paycheck. You know, it's nothing you can really pass down the generation. You know, after you're dead and gone, you can't pass that job down. You know, Alex Manley, he pretty much became a painter once he left Wilmington. And he pretty much had to pretend to be a white person to even get a good job as a painter because he was living in Philadelphia. And, you know, you had the white-only unions back then. So he couldn't really say he was a black guy. And like I said earlier, he could actually pass for white if he wanted to. So he actually had to pass for a white man to get a decent job back then, to take care of his family, even though, you know, after they done burnt his newspaper business down, when he moved to Philadelphia, he had to pretty much pass for a white guy to get a good union job, a good paying union job. So a lot of these families have been affected, man, and not only those families, but just black people in general, not only in North Carolina, but just throughout America, from certain Jim Crow laws and racism, white supremacy, whether it's through the educational system, through the business arena, whatever.
I can only emphasize again, multiply this by at minimum 260 times. Minimum 260 times. In that vein, you have one of Thomas Miller's descendants, I believe his great-granddaughter, Faye Chaplin. She's in the film. Just get our last sound clip in. Just really powerful clip that I want to share with listeners, and then if you want to share, give a comment on that. This is from, I cannot give enough praise, just really well done, outstanding project from Mr. Christopher Everett, Wilmington on Fire, Context of White Supremacy.
The banishment campaign had as its purpose to eliminate any potential for organization of the black community to retaliate against what was happening, either politically, legally, or physically. And so people like Thomas C. Miller and some of the preachers and some of the other civic folks were rounded up, arrested, and put in jail overnight on the night of the 10th. And on the morning of the 11th, they were told, get on this train, do not come back, or else you will be killed. And Ari Bryant tried, and he almost didn't get back out of the city about a year later. So it was an effort to remove the ability of the black community to come back together again and combat what was being done by the white supremacy movement.
I'd like to share with you a letter that was written by my great-grandfather. The letter is dated 7-9-1902. It's in the North Carolina State Archives in New Hanover County, and he wrote this to the Clerk of Superior Court. Colonel J.D. Taylor is who he addressed it to. And what he was doing, he had judgments on different doctors for monies that he had lent them. And at this point in his life, he was releasing these judgments. He was canceling these judgments. But I think in addition to that, he had a point that he wanted to get across. So he incorporated all of that into this letter. And I'm going to read you a little of what he was saying. what he said, he was saying that these doctors treated him as a human being, and that I shall continue to do, notwithstanding the way I have been treated, that for I have been treated not like human, but worse than a dog. And someday the Lord will punish them that punish me without cause. I am well, and I am doing well. The only thing that worries me is just that I was not allowed to come to my mother's funeral. She being 95 years old, the oldest citizen on Wrightsville Sound, just to think of it will take me to my grave. If I were guilty of any crime or I was a criminal, it would not worry me in the least, but oh my God, just to think, it is enough to run a sane man insane. He says at this time that just to think how my own people could treat me as they have without a cause. Oh my God, Colonel, please cancel the judgments against Dr. Mass and Reynolds. I remain your heartbroken servant as usual, T.C. Miller. It's just kind of upsetting to hear that someone can't go to their parents' funeral. It wasn't allowed. They just put you out of a city and you can't come back. You lose everything you've worked for. It's just really sad. But even reading this letter, I know he was a man of faith because he mentions God quite often in this.
Wilmington on Fire. Any comments, Mr. Everett?
Yeah, man, that was a powerful piece, man. And like I said, we show documentation. Like, we actually show the actual letter while she was reading it. You know, we show the actual letter, his handwriting and everything. You can see it. We found a lot of letters, man. Like I said, we're going to do a sequel to this thing and talk about some more things with it. But just finding letters like that, like I found a letter from Thomas C. Miller as well. He was speaking about his property. He was like, you know, what's going on with my property? Haven't heard from you guys in like over a year. What's the deal? And it shows you right there what these people were doing, you know, taking people's property, saying that they were going to do one thing. You know, even though you're banished, they'll say, well, you know, we'll take care of it. Just you can't come back in the city, you know. So it is crazy, man. How he just couldn't even come back to the city. You just go to your mom's funeral. You know, you weren't allowed to come back. And like I said, they were banished forever. If they came back, they would get killed on sight. So it was just a very, very powerful segment, you know, when she did that.
Mm-hmm. What's the current population of black people in Wilmington?
I say, man, it's about, 20,000, and it's about 75,000 white right now. So it's totally different from what it was prior to 1898. You know, black people are the minority right now. Like I said, it's about a little over 100,000 people in Wilmington. You got about 70-something thousand whites, about 20,000 blacks.
Was there, when the General Assembly in 2000 or early 2000s, when they North Carolina General Assembly decides, okay, we'll have an official state report to release, you know, the facts and what we deem to have actually happened with this event. Was there any conversation about, wow, there should be some restitution? Maybe we should, you know, compensate the black descendants who suffered?
See, the kind of, sort of, but like I said, people in my film like Larry Rennie Thomas, Queen Quett, Kent Chatfield, they've been speaking about this for years, saying that there needs to be compensation. The General Assembly, they didn't really do anything. I know when they did the report, they came up with 10 different things, right? When they came up with this report, they pretty much said, okay, these are the facts, this is the evidence of the report. Now, we want to implement these bills to go through the General Assembly. One of those was compensation to actual direct descendants. That was one of them. Number two, I think, was like to build some type of monument or something like that representing 1898 massacre in Wilmington. I think another one was, we're going to put this throughout the state of North Carolina in the school curriculum. Another one was, we're going to give a production company $500,000 to create a documentary that we can show locally throughout the state and throughout the country. Another one was, we're going to create a black business incubator, like a black business district in the city of Wilmington, to kind of help with the economic development for the black community in Wilmington. And it was a host of, like I said, it was about 10 different things. And compensation to descendants and stuff like that was one of them. None of the stuff got passed through the General Assembly. And you had a majority Democratic, you know, it's kind of funny, you know, because the Democrats are supposed to be liberal these days. But we had a majority Democratic General Assembly back then. They couldn't even get an apology passed through the General Assembly. And they didn't get none of those bills passed through either. So once they couldn't get that stuff through, it just died down, man. The whole 1898 buzz and everything just went away after that. And I think really until we came out with Wilmington on Fire, it's kind of sparked the plug again and it's got people talking about compensation and reparations and things like that again. But all that talk about reparations back then during the whole 1898 report, all that stuff got shot down. An apology got shot down. So you can't even get an apology through. You know you won't get no reparation. So that pretty much was the end result of that.
Wow. not that I'm in for, you know, white folks apologizing for what they have done to us. But if anything, I would just magnify that, because to me, you're telling me in explicit terms that you're not sorry for what your white grandfathers.
Yeah, pretty much.
You have no problem with it, right on. We took these niggas' property. We killed them by the thousands, maybe. And, you know, we're gangsters. That's what we do. Next, like, no problem. Just make that very clear. And that way we can teach it so we all have an accurate understanding of what racism is, how it works, and how we're dealing with the same notion. Like I said, continuum from Ben Tillman all the way to Dylan Storm Roof, continuum of what it means to be white and how they function. Did you get any funding for your project from, you know, the state of North Carolina or white people saying, hey, man?
I ain't getting no. I started this thing, you know how I funded this thing beginning when I first started? I lost my job and I was getting unemployment. That's how I first funded this thing, from unemployment money and my savings. And I just put everything I had into it, man. I did a couple of crowdfunding campaigns along the way through Indiegogo and Kickstarter. But I got lucky earlier this year. A guy, he plays in the NBA, actually. You know, he don't really want me to tell his name or nothing. But he plays in the NBA, and he's actually into black history and stuff like that. And he reached out to me. I thought he was playing. You know, his business partner reached out to me. And I thought this was a joke. I was like, man, I know this dude ain't hit me up. Like, who is this? Am I playing around? And then I actually talked to his business partner on the phone earlier this year, because I needed, you know, some money to finish the film, to pay for the archival stuff and some other things, editing and all that stuff, to finish it up. And so we talked, and I met him at one of the games when they came to play the Charlotte Hornets earlier this year. And, you know, he gave me a ticket and everything, and I talked to him afterwards, and we just made it happen, man. But that's how pretty much I got this whole thing done. Pretty much at the beginning, I used my own money and did crowdfunding stuff and sacrificed and things like that to get everything shot and all that. But to finish it up, a guy that plays in the NBA helped me out and gave me the finishing funds. And, you know, we have a finished product today, man. So you know, it pretty much was a combination of just my own sacrifice and hard work, and somebody recognized it, because he was actually following the film for a couple of years, and he was actually, he wanted to buy a DVD, he thought the film was done, and I said, nah, man, we still in post-production, you know, we need X amount of money to finish it, for post. He was like, oh, that's all you need? He said, well, let's set it up, and he just made it happen, so I'm really, really thankful, you know, that he was actually interested in the project and wanted to invest in it.
Outstanding. Even that right there, I'm reminded, because I've heard people criticize criticizing black people as a popular and activity enjoyed by many, but specifically criticizing black athletes for saying that they don't do enough and they don't help out and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
One, to have an example that, yes, this person did help, and then two, my suspicion in terms of them not wanting to be broadcast and have it announced that I did this, I helped fund this project, they are under a lot of pressure too. I could easily see how white people could say, oh, this is what you're going to do with your funds that we've allowed you to come
out
here? We will kindly excuse you out of our league. Now have fun and see if you can make some money doing something else. I could totally see whites doing something like that. Before I see if we take a few folks that called in, if they have questions, I wanted to give some much deserved appreciation. Jolly McNair, she did the illustrations for the film. Is that correct?
Wally. Yeah, Wally McNair, he did some of the illustrations, and Marcus Kaiser, like you might have seen, I think you posted a poster, one of the posters.
Yes, sir.
In the group. Marcus Kaiser, he does all those type of posters and all that stuff, the promo materials for the film. But Wally McNair, he's a great artist, man, brother out of Charlotte. Both of these guys are out of Charlotte, North Carolina. They're talented designers and illustrators, and I've been working with these guys for years, man. Like I said, when I did this film, I pretty much had access to a lot of people I've been knowing for years who were great, you know, cinematographers, musicians, everything, and I just reached out to everyone and said, hey, you know, I'm doing this project, and everybody wanted to get involved because, like I said, they've known me for years, and they believed in the project, and they believed in me. So we just all just combined, you know, our ideas together and just made it happen.
Wow. Outstanding. Is anything that was not included in this first run of the film that you wish, man, I wish we had got that in?
Yes, a couple of things, man. But it's like, I was like, I wanted to break this thing down in like the two more chapters because it's a lot. Because like I said, I think the first cut was like 4 hours. I was like, man, no one's going to sit around 4 hours and watch this thing. So, but it was a lot of things. I think, where did black people go after they left Wilmington? We're going to actually make that into a separate film. And a lot of people went to Whitesboro, New Jersey. And we were going to include that in the film, but I wanted to make that its own separate film because there's a lot that goes with it. And you probably, in some of your research about this topic, you might have heard of a guy named George Henry White. He was one of the last black congressmen, you know, I guess right before the Jim Crow era. You know, turn. And he was in North Carolina. He was a North Carolina congressman. And in 1900, when they pretty much established Jim Crow throughout North Carolina, he didn't get reelected. And he pretty much just told black people that they done did the 1898 massacre, and now they done did Jim Crow. You know, we just need to leave North Carolina. And he bought some land in Cape May County, New Jersey, and named this area after himself called Whitesboro. And a lot of black folks from Wilmington and throughout North Carolina, you know, resettled there. And the city, the town, it's a real small town. It reminds you of Wilmington in a way, but just a little smaller. It's like right on the coast of South New Jersey. And a lot of the town is still there today. And we actually interviewed a few people. We're going to go up there again this summer and reshoot some stuff and just make it its own separate thing. And that's probably going to be Wilmington on Fire, too. Just talk about the town of Whitesboro and its connection with the 1898 massacre. Just give it a different feel, you know what I'm saying? But a lot of people don't know about this town and its connection to 1898 and the state of North Carolina in general. But a lot of people up there know about their history, know about their connection with the 1898 massacre, and a lot of them had family from Wilmington that moved to Whitesboro, I think in 1904, I think about 1910, 1920. They actually moved to Whitesboro from Wilmington. And they were told, their people, like their grandparents and great-grandparents, were told never to really talk about 1898. That was a thing. when you move to Whitesboro, you don't talk about that. You know, I guess because of the fear. They thought that, it, you know, they would probably do the same thing in Whitesboro if they would keep bringing it up. But I think that's one of the things I wish I could have put in there. But I decided that we're just going to just make that its own film, you know, separate. So that was one of the main things I wish I would have put in.
Wow. Be on the lookout for the sequel. We will see if folks have any questions that they want to make sure they get in. I know we have, as I said, North Carolina listeners. You should definitely get a question in and make sure you check out and support Mr. Everett's work. Outstanding documentary. Can't give it enough accolades. The number of folks want to dial in is 641-715-3640. And the code is 564-943-pound. Press *6 if you have a question. The person that dialed in, last four digits, 4950, did you have a question for Mr. Everett? You should be with us.
Greetings, the Gus, all of the listeners, the callers, Mr. Everett. This kind of touched home because I have a mom that's from she's from Cumberland, VA, and she always never wanted to talk about her sister that's been missing since they were teenagers. My mom is about 67, I believe, now. I had a question. I want to know, like, when you were researching this stuff, did it make you angry and kind of, like, want to retaliate? I know sometimes, like, when I watch stuff like Rosewood and stuff like that, I get upset and I feel like I want to do something about it.
Yeah, kind of, sort of. You know, I got kind of angry, you know, when I looked up old letters and you know, like, in hearing, even when I was interviewing, man, just hearing certain stories from certain, you know, actual direct descendants, and then you see how they're, you know, some of the financial struggles they're going through and things like that. It made me real angry. But, you know, I had to keep my composure and keep my cool, and I was like, you know, the best thing I can do is just make the best film I can possible, get this story out, and hopefully, you know, some type of justice will come through with that. Because I know if I come go out here and start swinging on folks, all that's going to happen to me is I'm either going to get shot or thrown in jail. You know what I'm saying? Even though I might want to do that, you know, it's not going to benefit nobody. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to end up getting thrown in jail or getting shot. So I'm like, yo, let me keep my cool, keep my composure. But that's just human nature. You know, you're going to feel a certain way, especially researching this type of stuff. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, I definitely felt some type of anger somewhat. But I just had to, you know, keep my composure and keep my cool and just keep, you know, moving with the task at hand.
Okay. Oh, okay, thank you. I appreciate the answer and your feedback. Thanks, Gus.
Oh, caller that dialed in, I think this is our caller in Canada. Did you have a question for Mr. Everett?
Yes, that's me. Okay, I've been following lately the arguments between Du Bois and Garvey about, you know, Du Bois was a socialist and Garvey defended capitalism. And looking at what happened in Wilmington, very similar to what happened in Tulsa, very similar, this even happened in Canada up in Halifax, a city called Africville. So these acts of white terrorism are definitely not new. Are these actions, these behaviors, whenever a black community gets successful and whites want to use all sorts of violence to thrash it down, is it not a sign possibly that white supremacy in and of itself isn't really contingent on capitalism as an economic system, but perhaps just an anti-black capitalism in which they don't really want blacks to really be engaged in capitalism? Because, you know, they don't want us to compete in the free market. They want to completely shut us out from building anything that we... Basically, they don't want blacks to use it to their advantage. And in light of this, I don't know if you're familiar with the class struggle argument that socialists often use, is, you know, if we get together with other non-white people and especially poor whites, that, you know, we have a better chance and we can get further, you know, end racism. So basically, would socialism end racism, that kind of thing? How does what happened in Wilmington reflect on that?
Well,
or shape your response to that. That's what, sorry.
Yeah. With the last thing where you were talking about, you know, the whole, you know, I guess what poor white and black coalition and stuff like that. Well, you know, they tried that in Wilmington. That was the whole fusionist movement, and you saw what happened with that. You know, so that's like the first answer for that. Because I think the whole capitalism thing as well, I think it's all of the above. I think, you know, you have white supremacists that don't want black people to be competitive. But I look at Wilmington today. Black people, they don't really own and control anything in Wilmington. But you still have a white system, a white supremacy system that is still taking property and land from poor black people. Prime real estate is throughout Wilmington because it's a beach city. You have a nice riverfront area. So gentrification is running rampant throughout the city right now, today. And majority of black people that they're taking this property from by doing these different strategies are just, you know, just poor black folks. They ain't even thinking about starting no business or nothing. So I think it's all of the above, man. I think they're attacking black folks, you know, who are trying to start businesses like they were doing back in the day, but also just the average black person in general, because a lot of black folks don't even really think about economics and building another Black Wall Street or whatever. But white folks are still constantly terrorizing black people still. So I think it's just all of the above. I don't think it has anything to do with class or capitalism. I just think it's just all about white supremacy.
Wow. Appreciate that caller in Canada, just N.D.B. Connolly, again, fantastic book. I would encourage folks to read it, A World More Concrete. He emphasized on the program that whites have become increasingly efficient at confiscating black property, that it has refined from Wilmington On Fire, going in with guns and whatever else, Gatling guns, and gun the black people down and take it that way, to now, oh, you're late on your property tax, so we got to take your property, or we're increasing the property tax in this area, now you can't afford it, or all these new manifestations of how they can do the same thing that happened in Wilmington, but doing it more efficiently. The caller at 5640, did you have a question for Mr. Everett? You should be with us.
Good evening to Gus and to the guests. I wanted to know, in the immediate aftermath of the attack, where does the black residents seek refuge? I did hear that one of the victims tried to hide in a cemetery, but I don't know if you addressed that in the film. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, a lot of them, a lot of people hid in the cemeteries. They actually hid there for weeks. And what's amazing is that a lot of people don't even know where the cemetery is, Gus. And, you know, we actually show it in the film. And every time I come to Wilmington, I go by that cemetery, you know, just to pay my respect. Because a lot of, like I said, this is very sacred ground, man. And what's the trip is that a lot of black folks in Wilmington don't even know where this place is at, in Wilmington, don't even know where it is. And that's where a lot of black folks, you know, hid during the massacre for a few weeks, actually. And a lot of them hid there. And you also had a few white allies as well who let a lot of black folks, you know, stay in their homes until the massacre stopped. But you had a lot of black folks that just left. They just packed their stuff or they just left everything they had, just got out of town. A lot of them got on the trains and on ferries and everything. If they could make it out alive, they just got out. And a lot of them moved, you know, went to Durham, and then from Durham went to Norfolk, Virginia, went to Philadelphia, New York. They went to Whitesboro eventually and other places. But they just pretty much just went wherever they could go and hide. Like I said, some went to a few white folks' house, white folks who were sympathetic of black folks back then in the city of Wilmington. Some went to the cemetery to hide for weeks. Some of them died out there because it's in November. You know, it was like November of, you know, you know, November 10th back then. So it's not like now where we got, it's like 70 degrees in November. You know, they had the hard winters back then. So you had people out there freezing in the cold for weeks. So some of them died out there in the actual, in the cemetery. So they pretty much just went and ran and hid wherever they could go. If they could get out of town, then they would do that as well. So it was just pretty much a combination of all of that.
Wow. And this, you touch on in the film, this cemetery at the time, this was the all-black cemetery. They didn't want...
Yes, and it's still there. It's still the color. It's still considered the black. And like I said, it's still there today. You saw with my man Larry. He was there. And what's a shame is that, man, like the cemetery, it's never well kept. You know, in the summertime, the grass is all up. You know, it's like a foot high and trash everywhere, and I'm like, wow. So I'm pretty much going to organize soon, man, like a real, real thorough cleanup and try to always keep it clean. But when you go to the white cemetery, and we're going to show this in the, this is another thing I wish I would have had in this film, but I just couldn't put it in there. I'm going to put it in the next one or put it in the bonus thing of the DVD, where you go to the white cemetery, where the people who actually did the massacre, and this cemetery is called Oakdale. And it's near there. And their cemetery is laid out, man. They got the paved roads. They got it real clean. They got the Confederate flags everywhere flying high. And they got stuff on the headstones, right, of people that were involved in the massacre, saying that they were God-fearing people and they were statesmen and all this and that. And they got people that were putting money. They actually come by and put dollars and coins on their gravestones and everything. So it's a totally different... Look, these two cemeteries, the cemetery of the people who actually did the massacre is looks a certain way, and the people who actually, you know, that were victims of this thing, their cemetery looks totally different as well.
Caller, I think this is Roz. Did you have a question for Mr. Christopher Everett? You should be with us.
Yes, good evening. Good evening to you, Gus, and good evening to you, Mr. Everett. I did have a question for you. I wanted to ask if you found that there was a spiritual component to making this film. The reason I ask is because I come from a family where there's a lot of hidden information, too. And I found out that my wife's father, or my father-in-law, was actually related to the Trenton Six, which was a big, big racial incident that took place in Trenton, New Jersey in the 1940s. And no one in the family ever spoke about it. And when we found out about it, my wife ended up doing some artwork and having some exhibits related to that. So it was like the ancestors kind of opened the way. And I wanted to know if you had an experience like that while making this film.
I think so, man, because, you know, when I first started doing this film, I didn't really know this thing had North Carolina, like Laurinburg ties. I'm from Laurinburg, North Carolina. And then when I wanted to do it, I just felt like, I don't know, just something told me that I just need to do this thing. Like I said, I didn't have no money. I got laid off from a job and nothing. But something just told me I just need to go ahead and do this thing, man. And when I started researching, and I found out that, like, people like what we talked about earlier, like Ben Tillman, a lot of those guys came to my hometown back then to do speeches in Laurinburg. Ben Tillman, he came through there talking about the 1898 stuff. They had a lot of the red shirts was heavy in Laurinburg, in my hometown back then. Because, like, I think a lot of the photos of red shirts in North Carolina, the only ones you can actually find are ones of red shirts in Laurinburg, in my hometown. And I always found that fascinating. Like, wow. But something always told me that I just need to do this for some reason. But I think that Laurinburg connection with the red shirts and Ben Tillman always coming there doing speeches, and he would come to Fayetteville. Fayetteville was real close to Laurinburg as well. So I think just stuff like that was like, you know what, I need to go ahead and do this thing. It just something always told me I just need to just go ahead and do it. And it just felt right, you know, to always do it and just continue to do it, whether I had no money or not. Just something always told me to just keep moving and keep moving forward.
Thank you very much, and thanks for the work you're doing. I'm looking forward to the second one as well. Thank you.
For sure. Caller at 5715. Did you have a question for Mr. Everett? You should be with us.
Yeah, we're trying to figure out when he's going to get to Philadelphia. Peace, good brother. This is Professor Carl Jones.
Hey, what's up, man?
What's going on, my brother? Just I'm just really happy that the film is out and that people have access to the true history in regards to not just the actual slaughter and the massacre that took place, but also to the prominence of the black community post-Civil War. You know, a lot of times we study, you know, our history, and it goes from slavery to the emancipation to the Civil Rights Movement to the Civil Rights Laws, and it never really talks about the time in between. We, as you said, sir, who, you know, we had over 260 prominent black boom towns in this country post-Civil War, post-antebellum. And one of the things that I think is important is when you spoke about the media and the media controlling their tactical move to knock out the mass media for our community at that time, which was the newspaper, and how they took that and utilized that to control the story afterwards. And I look to that, and I look to what happened just last year when you had, the year and a half ago when you had the situation with Mike Brown, and how the collective media tried to black that story out, but because we had social media and we had an alderman by the name of Antonio French tweet all the things that were going on in Ferguson, the people got an opportunity to actually see what was happening versus what the corporate media was trying to sell. And I think that's a very powerful point to make in regards to the media manipulation in terms of how they handle stories and how they treat these things and project them towards our history. So, you know, I'm just real grateful for that, and I'm real thankful that the film is finally out.
Didn't hear. Did you have a response, Mr. Everett? I didn't really hear a question, but do you have a response?
Oh, no. Nah. He's right on. He's right on point with it, man. He pretty much laid it out. Nothing left to explain on that one.
Right on. Appreciate it.
Well, we're looking forward to getting you up there in Philly, brother, and we're working on that now. So I'll be in touch with you real soon. And thanks again for hosting this show. It's a wonderful show.
For sure. Appreciate that.
Black brother, hell.
Let's see. Person that called in from a blocked number. Did you have a question for Mr. Everett? You should be with us.
Good evening. How on the chillin' to do this evening?
I'm sorry.
Hey, what's up, Queen Quit?
Okay. Peace and blessings. I know Hunter would have known who this is. I'm very happy to hear both of you. I've been on here from the beginning of the show and thought there were some very powerful highlights about the film. And I wanted to present a couple of things from some of the statements you all made, just to hear you maybe further elaborate on whether you thought about this, Brother Christopher, throughout the making of the film and now all these discussions about the film, now that all of your fans are glad it's out. Is one of the things you mentioned was that there was military science, and you mentioned the fact that they had a plan. You said that over and over, they had a plan. Yeah. And I wondered if you've looked at it in the way that I've looked at it, that part of military science does include what was captured in the film Manchurian Candidate, and how that has not been in favor of our people who have been military trained coming back to protect our communities, but instead being indoctrinated into believing that they're accepted in the mainstream community.
Yeah.
And that's my part one. My part two is just a statement. You all both made the statement about white supremacy being a religion, and I thought it unfortunate that black pride and black unity are not religions.
Yeah.
And I think it kind of ties in also with the assimilation and indoctrination that comes from these things like military science and white supremacy, as you all have been couching it in the discussion. So I'd love to know if you've thought about that in the context of all of this that you put together.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And like I said, I couldn't really put everything in the first film, and that's why I want to get you back for the second as well. Yeah, because this Queen Quest, she's in the film as well. And those are things I've definitely thought about. And I'm in agreement with you 100% on both of those statements. Yeah, I can't argue with you on that one.
I didn't expect you to argue. I just thought you might even.
Oh no, I'm just saying. I'm in agreement with you. I totally agree with you.
I hear you, and I'm definitely pleased to know that both of you have honed in on and given people further homework by the reading material that's been expressed throughout this discussion tonight, because so many of us just want to watch on the screen, you know, sit there, eat popcorn or sucking on chicken wings or whatever they're doing, and then after that it's just some rhetoric for the room. But land, black land ownership, and that's why I guess you chose me to be in this first one, and I guess you'll be coming at me again for the second one now, is my daily mission, as you know, because when we talk about black wealth and we talk about black empowerment, there's none of the above if we don't own anything that we can then be empowered on, that we can feed ourselves from, by literally being able to grow our own food on this coast, literally being able to own and operate our own businesses and institutions, and then teaching and training our people on our own land. If we leave this in the hands of others, we'll only have more Wilmington situations. And I was saddened by my first visits to Wilmington because I didn't really understand what the mindset was up there of other people of African descent until I started doing some research. And I think that your film and discussions like this are going to truly enlighten the many more who are actually awake, and I pray it helps to awaken the others who are sleepwalking as to what this mentality is that I've seen in Wilmington and throughout North Carolina, because someone didn't even want to give me a tour of a church and got in trouble for fully giving me a tour of a downtown church because they knew who I was. And this is a black church, and this was only a few years ago. And this person got in trouble because they were like, oh, no, she comes to try to have meetings and bring people together around Gullah Geechee and nationhood. We can't have that. So your film, I pray, definitely opens a discussion that's long needed to have been held, and hopefully we can retrain some minds here.
I totally agree.
I just wanted to comment real quick the first portion of your commentary where you were talking about the black people who might have participated in some component of the armed forces and not taking whatever skills or expertise that they gain while they're doing that and then coming back to protect black people here, or just trying to do the best they can to help black people with those skills that they pick up. It might not be the case as much now, but I know particularly after World War II that was huge.
Oh, yeah.
There were massive numbers of black veterans who came back who were kind of at the forefront of things that were happening in the 50s and 60s. I know James Meredith was a veteran. I know Geronimo Pratt with the Black Panther Party was a veteran. Even right. Jackie Robinson, veteran. And I mean, it's a long list. Even a lot of the people, if folks go and dig, like Deacons of Defense down in the
Deacons
South.
Deacons of Defense, I was going to mention,
They were a ton of black veterans. In fact, I think there's a whole body of scholarship on the number of black veterans, particularly black World War II veterans who came back and did exactly that, used that expertise to try to help black people as best they could, and even around armed self-defense. I think I mentioned at the beginning of the program, Scotty Reed, founder of the Black Talk Radio Network, so he's talked on this program many times that he served in the military. I think he adds, unfortunately, that he wouldn't do it if he had it to do over again, but he took those skills and helped establish Black Talk Radio Network so that we have a platform for black journalists and to help get this sort of information out. So I definitely think there should be more of it, but there is a long legacy of black people who have done that, that have really done a lot to try to help black people out as best they could.
Yes, we just need to add to it, and I think educating people that existed prior to them maybe would help. So I really hope that a lot of our veterans that are listening now heard what you said and will research these names and truly then maybe take a different perspective in terms of what's going on in our communities.
Ashe. Did you have anything else you wanted to get in before we hit our next caller?
No, just want to definitely congratulate you for the program and appreciate you for featuring Wilmington on Fire on it. I'm looking forward to next month. I'm actually coming out of my hiatus only because a certain filmmaker contacted me and is dragging me up to North Carolina next month for the next showing. And so I'm definitely looking forward to us enlightening some more folks and definitely to setting this on fire and causing a blaze in the hearts and minds of African people that we should stand up and stand together if we want better communities. So I appreciate you both, brothers. Keep up the work that you're doing. It's needed. Peace and blessings.
Peace and blessings.
Peace. Appreciate that. Appreciate that. In the film, if you watch it, you'll see her. Person that dialed in, last four digits, 6353. Did you have a question for Mr. Everett?
Yes. This is Sunny from L.A. I suspect that this is just the tip of the iceberg regarding the black land grab that's been going on. I know you guys have been doing outstanding work gathering authors who have made comments and written books to inform us more, and it's wonderful. Richard Williams's book that we reviewed on your program, the way I see it, speaks about it, black families being forced and terrorized into signing over their properties and productive farms and so forth. One especially efficient way that I think more refined racism and how they're doing this now, I would say that the housing crisis was a good example of the refined way that they're now confiscating our properties. Finally, I wanted to point out that this current day refrain that we keep hearing in politics, we're going to take our country back, I would say that stems from the same evil vine that they spring from with this, as if they have a legitimate claim on any region or place on the planet, except that cold, barren, frigid, callous, cavernous area called the Caucasus Mountains they originated from, I hear. But my question is, what do you think about the approach, the strategy, the technique? In other words, they take time in some instances, especially your Wilmington story, where they looking for a reason, you know, what's going to be, how are we going to do this? I'd like for you to talk about how they strategize their for confiscating and pillaging, raping and murdering when it comes to taking what belongs to other people. You understand my question?
Yes. Well, then pretty much, I would say, when we talk about this in the film, you know, it kind of stems from, I would say, from the Civil War. That was like what Gus mentioned earlier. A lot of your main players behind the 1898 massacre, a lot of them actually fought in the Civil War for the Confederacy. A lot of them were generals, majors, colonels, and everything. And we all know that if it wasn't for black soldiers, the North wouldn't have won the Civil War. And I think a lot of that carried over with them, with the Confederacy. After losing the black soldiers and you know, and all that, and then they come, a lot of them come back to Wilmington, and you see black folks prospering and getting involved in the political arena and becoming business owners and landowners and stuff like that. I think a lot of that played into their psyche, you know. And I think, honestly, we kind of talk about it in the film, I honestly think that they begin plotting and strategizing something like this, I would say, right after the end of the Civil War, honestly. Mm-hmm. I think they did. I think they really said, you know what, we're going to plot and we're going to plan. And that's how white supremacy works. They don't, and that's the thing that a lot of black people don't understand, that white supremacy, they don't, you know, they can wait 40, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years to get you. You know, we think that someone's going to get you like the next week. You know, if they don't get us in a week or a year's time, we think that, okay, it's over with. But white supremacy, they'll wait, you know, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years to really strike on you. And that's what they did in Wilmington. You know, they, like I said, I honestly think they waited, they really plotted on doing this to black people right at the end of the Civil War. And like I said, 30 to 40 years after they did the 1898 Wilmington Massacre. And that's the thing that I think black people really need to understand when it comes to white supremacy. We always have to be alert. because they're always on alert. And they could take, like I said, a week, a month, a year, 5 years, 10 years, 20, 30, 40, 50, even 100 to really put some type of plan on. We always got to stay awake. And I think that's what we really need to do.
Right on, right on. I think we nabbed all of the callers, unless, you know, somebody lollygagging. You should not be hanging around. Go ahead and get your hand up if you have a question, like within the next minute or so, if you have a question you want to make sure you get in to Mr. Everett. I just wanted to ask, I had two quick ones. Number one, where did you find Ken Chatfield? This is a white male. You all heard him in the first audio clip that we had, white man who had, I mean, it's he has a PhD, to me, it seems, in what happened in 1898. Where did you find him at? And he seemed very enthused to talk about this subject matter.
Well, he, I found him, remember I told you this guy knew Larry Thomas, who's in the film. He's known Kent for years, and Kent actually provided, like, a lot of the people that I have in the film, like Larry, Professor Sandy Darity, Kent, a lot of them actually contributed to the 1898 Race Riot Report, along with Lorraine Unfleet. Lorraine Unfleet did the full report, but she also had to get further research and things from people, and Kent was one of those people as well. But Larry's known him for some years, and Larry told me, he said, hey, man, you need to get up with this brother named, this guy named Kent Chatfield. He has a lot of good things, and, you know, I've known him for some time. And so, you know, I reached out to him, and he had a lot of info. And the thing is, he came from a different perspective. He came from, you know, the white side of this. And being around a lot of these people who had ties, you know, who were actually actual direct descendants of some of the people who actually did this massacre. He kind of knew a lot of their families. He went to one of the churches. He actually went to the church where, when you do research, the Wilmington Light Infantry building, his church is right beside that building. So he talks about that, like when you played at the beginning, you know, when he was a kid and he was in Boy Scouts and stuff like that. They would go, you know, from that church and go to that building, and there would be an old man. He was like in his late 90s. And he was actually, I think, probably a teenager in 1898. And he would talk about what happened in 1898 because he was there. And he remembers all these stories. And he brought up a lot of this stuff when they were actually talking about 1898 in the, you know, in, I guess, 1995 or 93. And he would tell them, he was telling them all this stuff and a lot of his research and things he heard growing up. And a lot of times they really just didn't pay attention to it. And I was like, yo, man, a lot of your stuff really is holding weight because you got documentation to back it up. You know, let's put it in the film. And, you know, we just made it happen, man. But like I said, he really brought a lot of, I guess, a wealth of knowledge that a lot of people might, you know, I guess, see when they read the actual report. But a lot of stuff, if they watch the film, he brings a lot of stuff that you rarely even heard about.
Yeah, not that I was surprised, because I think anyone who's heard this program, I emphasize all the time that white people are not ignorant about racism. That is, you know, just a huge misnomer, lie, mythology. But particularly where he had the document where he showed where, okay, this is a coup d'etat and we are going to replace, or we're going to add racists to the council, and they go around and get their petition to get the signatures. And he said that you can just check. I went, and he said he did the research. You could look at the signatures and then go find these people's addresses, and you could see the route that the mob took where they just went house to house. I was like, wow, that is extensive detail in terms of knowing what happened down to block by block where the mob went to get their signatures for the petition to take over the council.
Yeah, like I said, man, he's done extensive research on it, man, and he actually got all the names. He actually wrote down the names. He searched where their business addresses were, where their home addresses were, you know, and he said all of them were connected to the Democratic Party and the white government union, all of them. And that all of them had, like, key parts in holding the information as well. Like, some of the people actually were over the Postal Service, were over the telegraph lines, over the ferry services. And see, that's how, like I said, man, that's how they were able to control the narrative, control the story. Because you had people that owned the newspaper, that owned the ferry lines, the telegraph lines, they were over the Postal Service. So they control the information, so they control the story, and that's how they were able to control the narrative for over 100 years, pretty much saying that it was black people's fault, that it really wasn't, you know, this, you know, slaughter of black folks is only like 10 people killed, and we had to rise up because of the corruption of government, you know, and that, and Kent really lays it out on how they were able to really, really control the narrative and pull this stuff off.
One of the earlier things that you brought out in terms of you being able to get the information with the property deeds, the theft of black land, where you said, hey, I don't have a PhD. And Ken Chatfield, this white man, he doesn't have a PhD either, but you all were able to track down this information. And some of these white people were not able to get this information to include this. Again, I think the way you said him, Lorraine Umfleet, and she's, it seems like, one of the white people who was high up in terms of in charge of the commission that was put together by the North Carolina General Assembly to investigate this initial, quote unquote, official report. Did she have this information on the deeds and the black property theft?
Yes, see, the thing is, see, man, my man, Kent, he actually showed her this stuff. He showed everything with the white government union, showed the petition list, showed the deeds and everything. But she didn't really pay attention to it. You know, and that was funny. I was like, okay, why didn't you pay attention to it? She just ignored it and just went on her business, you know. But the thing is, you know, she can only, I guess, say so much. But, you know, she still provided great commentary and things we needed in the film to kind of piece everything together. But, you know, she had to work for the state, you know. And she, I guess she had to do what she had to do. But the thing is, you know, we're really... We've actually brought out a lot of new things that are finally, you know, I guess, new to the table that should have been in the report, but they aren't. But, you know, I guess that's what the film is, you know, I guess that's why the film is really needed. So,
In my opinion, white people do not get the benefit of the doubt for those type of massive omissions that are supremely important. In my view, that is an act of racism on her part. If she was,
yeah, it is.
They pressured her to do it or told her you can't put that in because we're not going to pay these niggas anything. So you might as well just leave that. However it happened, that is an act of racism.
And see, the thing is, Gus, and see, that's what we're going to talk about. And like I said, we got two sequels. We got one that's talking about Whitesboro. And the third one, the final one, is going to talk about what you just talked about. We're going to talk about why they didn't put these things in the report. You know, why these bills that they created for reparations and all that, what happened to them? Why did they didn't get passed? And also about the gentrification that's going on today as well. So we're going to, that's why I was like, you know what, I want to break this thing up. You know what I'm saying? And we're definitely going to address that issue in the next one.
Outstanding, outstanding. And just again, multiply this by 260 at least. This is consistent. When white people, I think Elliot Jaspany says that white people, they lie. They will make up some fantasy about, oh, it was Negro crime or whatever. And then they will just say, oh, well, there was something unfortunate happened. But, you know, we paid the black people for their property and moved forward. And yeah, it was bad, but things are much better now. These, the way that they will talk about to minimize the terrorism and the loss of wealth, loss of property that happened to black people. This is consistent where they are very deceptive in not giving out total information about what happened, the black death, the numbers of black people who died in all of this. And then we're going to make sure that there's no compensation. We're going to make sure that there's no repair for what happened in all of this. Even though we benefited greatly, you see this consistently throughout the pattern, as I said, at least 260 times, more than that, that this happened. Just, I guess, finally, the connection, because this comes out very early in the film, and we've talked about the Wilmington 10 before. How are those events connected? What happened in the 60s with the Wilmington, late 60s, early 70s with the Wilmington 10 and the Wilmington massacre?
Well, the whole thing with when, you know, you have, like you say, you talked about the Wilmington 10, but the Wilmington 10 situation, that really put the spotlight on the city of Wilmington. That really put the attention. Because people were like, okay, what's going on in this little city? You know, what's going on with all this racial tension and stuff like that with the Wilmington 10 and, you know, and the KKK and the bombing and all this stuff like that? You know, what is going on in this town? And then that's when people started talking about, well, it goes back to 1898. Because any book that you had that you read about the Wilmington 10, they're always going to have a chapter in there by 1898. You have to put it in there because that's the root of the issue in Wilmington. is what happened in 1898. You know, so when the Wilmington 10 situation happened, that really put the spotlight, like I said, it put the spotlight on the city of Wilmington. And when you put the spotlight on Wilmington, and when you're looking at the racism and its racial history, 1898 is right there. And that's what really brought the attention of, okay, this place is, you know, this is, like I said, in certain books and writings and stuff, they actually say that Wilmington was the capital of the white supremacy movement back then. I know Woodrow Wilson, you know, who's a known white supremacist. A lot of people don't know this. He actually spent his childhood in Wilmington. They have a marker in downtown Wilmington. His father, I think, was a pastor of one of the churches here. And he spent some of his childhood here in Wilmington. So, you know, I guess he gets his white supremacy honest. You know, he gets it honest. So,
right know. On. The religion of white supremacy, indeed. Yeah.
But see, that's the thing, man, that the Wilmington situation, that really put the spotlight on the city and really had people starting to dig. And they found out, you know, the whole thing with 1898 and found out that this place, man, is just synonymous with just racial terrorism against black people.
Wow. What is the best place if folks want to support, if they want to invest in your future projects, if they want to get information about how they can purchase the film or future screenings, where would you direct people to go to get that information?
Well, the film isn't available for purchase right now. We're still getting the DVD together. Like, we're doing festivals and doing our own screenings right now. But we're getting the website together right now. It should be up and running in about 2 weeks, and that's WilmingtonOnFire.com. But for right now, people can just go on Facebook, facebook.com/WilmingtonOnFire, facebook.com/WilmingtonOnFire. We have everything about upcoming screenings, and we even got a soundtrack as well out there on SoundCloud for people who can check that out for free. And if you want to set up a screening in your city or your town, whatever, just email me. You can just hit me up at facebook.com/WilmingtonOnFire, or you can just email me personally at WilmingtonOnFire@gmail.com. And, you know, we can see if we can set up a screening out in your city or your area.
Wow. I would encourage folks, particularly if you're North Carolina or anywhere close to that region, you should definitely look into seeing if you can get a screening of the film, purchase a copy of the DVD. It is amazing, one of the best documentaries that I've seen, and you will learn a lot. It's just chock full of just outstanding information, and as I said, I just don't have enough praise. It is fantastic, and would encourage folks to support. Keep an eye out, and then if there are going to be sequels and what have you, you should support those as well. Just outstanding information, and again, breaking that legacy of us not talking about these type of incidents or not talking about it accurately, where we end up being corrupted by racists and using their type of terminology and calling it a race riot or an unfortunate disturbance, that sort of thing. No, let's get all the accurate information out about exactly what happened, because this goes a long way to helping us explain and understand why things look the way that they do right now. Just cannot thank you enough, Mr. Everett, for being willing to come and share some of your time and expertise with us. Outstanding film, and really enjoy the last couple hours that we've been able to discuss things.
Man, thank you for having me on. Like I told you in the email past couple weeks, man, I listen to your show all the time. You know, so when you reached out to me, I was like, yeah, I got to do this, because I'm an avid, you know, I listen to your show all the time, man. I've been listening to it for years, so it's been a pleasure being on the show.
For sure. And he even included the link. I was going to put the information up for Reverend Kirk, and he beat me to it on the Facebook page. So I appreciate the extra.
I emailed you the comment, the quote from, I think, Ben Tillman is what I think I emailed you.
Oh,
here it is. Let me read it for you
quick. Yes, sir.
Here it is. He said, Ben Tillman. He said, in South Carolina, no Negro editor could slander the white woman of the state as that Wilmington Negro did. That Negro ought now to be food for catfish in the bottom of the Cape Fear River instead of going around above ground. He pretty much was talking about, Alex Manley.
Wow. Again, yeah. Ben Tillman, the continuing Mr. Tillman, all the way up to Dylan Storm Roof, you get this sort of information, you get a much better understanding of what we are dealing with when we talk about what it means to be white. Outstanding information, Mr. Christopher Everett. Thank you so much for being willing to come on the program. Anytime you'd like to come back to promote the other films or anything that any of the projects that you're working on, just let me know, and we would love to have you back anytime, sir.
Oh, cool. No doubt. I'll do that.
Outstanding. Please enjoy the rest of your evening. Continue the fantastic work, and we'll be promoting, letting folks know about screenings and what have you. You can follow on Twitter as well to get updates and information about the work that he's going to be doing. But thank you so much. Keep up the outstanding work, and we will be in touch, sir.
Cool.
A plus. Context of White Supremacy. We will take a quick commercial break. I do have one comment that I want to get in, because I went back and I was listening to the program that we did with Elliot Jaspin, just as 260 of these. Just a quick comment on that, something that I heard from that program that I wish I had listened to that program sooner. But at any rate, quick comment on that. But we'll take a quick commercial break, and then we'll be right back. If anybody has anything quick that they want to get in before we wrap things up, we should have time for that as well. But quick commercial, Context of White Supremacy. We will be right back.
RacismDaily.com, your number one source for global news reports on race, racism, and overt actions of white supremacy. From Asia to the Americas to Europe to Australia to Africa, racism is not a thing of the past. It is our current reality. Be informed. Be globally informed. You should be the first to know. RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com, RacismDaily.com.
Is racism hurting you? On issues of race, are you unable to speak, think, and act with clarity and confidence? Are you tired of laughing when nothing is funny, smiling when you are not happy, agreeing when you really disagree? At counterracism.com, you can learn specific strategies and techniques to counter the behaviors of the people who practice racism in all areas of activity. Using words correctly, following counter-racist logic, even counter-racist science projects designed to reveal what racism is, how it works, and how to counter it. The open source code writing format allows you to pick and choose from a variety of counter-racist suggestions so you can produce the code that works for you. Stop by counterracism.com today and help replace racism with justice.
That's counter-racism.com.
Do you need a one-stop shop for all of your multimedia needs? Triumphant Multimedia is a skilled team of professionals with a passion for great marketing and chic design. Our specialties include consulting, brand development, copywriting, and creative graphic design. That's second to none. We also offer photography, photo retouching, videography, and video editing. At Triumphant Multimedia, our goal is to provide highly effective creative solutions built to suit any individual need or budget. Give us a call at 678-732-8067 or check us out online at TRIMultimedia.com.
Context of White Supremacy. We should be back tomorrow. We should have a non-white, non-black female on the program. She wrote an essay like last month where she was talking about why she would not have any sort of sexual relationships with white people directly related to her understanding and experience of racism. That is not a common sentiment, so I was certainly interested in hearing details on how she came to this conclusion and writing about it, and just hearing her perspective as a non-white, non-black person on the system of white supremacy. But that should be tomorrow. I'll post the essay so folks can check it out if you want to do some homework in preparation for tomorrow. But that'll be same broadcast time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. That said, Quickly, as I said, I definitely got to get my comment in about Elliot Jaspin, because that was hugely important when I was kind of doing some research, preparing for the program, and just going back and remembering exactly what he said about how frequent these events are. And that's something I would really, let me see if I can put my hand on the sound clip, because I said that there are so many different instances that where this has happened, where whites went in, terrorized the whole black area, killed who knows how many black people, and then forced the rest of them to exit the town and never come back. This happened so many times. Definitely, you should check out Banished by Marco Williams. Trouble Behind is another documentary where this happened in Kentucky. This did not take place every time somewhere in the Deep South or what have you, where the same thing happened in Kentucky. Let me see if I can get the sound clip from the film Trouble Behind. If I can't put my hand on it too quick, then we'll have to save it for another day, but I think I can nab it. I just saw it. This film is older. This film came out like 30 years ago, I believe. I just found out about it recently, within the last few months this year. Someone shared that this project was out, and it is fascinating. And this is another one where it's the same pattern where I said where white people lie about what happened. They know what happened. I think what Mr. Fuller says all the time, you cannot be a master deceiver if you don't have accurate information. It's not that white people don't know these things. They are very aware about what happened. It's just they lie to us about what happened so that we are confused, so that we are not presenting accurately about the system of racism, white supremacy. Let's see here. Oh, bang, this is from Trouble Behind. So this is same thing, Wilmington on Fire, same thing, but this is in Kentucky. This is just a quick snippet from one of the white descendants, likely race soldier, where he's talking about his view on racism, white supremacy, and specific matter. I'll just play the clip. This is from Trouble Behind. You can find this online if you want to watch a different region where the same thing happened.
Be ungrateful to me.
I had a dog growing up. Show you a picture of him. Black, white feet, white throat, little white tip on his tail. I loved that dog. That dog knew when I was going to service. He knew when I got in trouble. He knew when I was phoning home. He'd come up, lay on the porch, and look at the phone. And it'd ring if it was from me. He'd bark like wild, make sure somebody answered the phone. You know what his name was? Nigger.
Nigger!
And that was your dog?
That's right. I loved that dog. That wasn't no bad name. That's because he was black, shiny, pretty, muscular. Come on, nigger. You see? I wasn't using it in a bad way. They were run out of town not because they were black. They were run out of Corbin because they were drinking, gambling, and raising all kinds of cane with their newfound pocket money from the railroad.
See there? Exact same story in Kentucky. You heard Dixie at the end there. One of our favorite tunes here on the Context of White Supremacy. But that quick snippet, that is from Trouble Behind. It's not as good as Wilmington on Fire, but it's pretty darn entertaining and informative. I would encourage folks to check it out. I think you can find it online, but so many of the same patterns. I cannot say that enough. You'd have to multiply this by at least 260 to really grasp what we're talking about when we say racial cleansings and these events. It's not just Rosewood. It's not just Black Wall Street. It's not just Wilmington. At least 260 times. And Elliot Jaspin, he said, I know it's more than that, because that number is just when they kicked out all the black people from the entire county. There were times recorded where it was just in the city. It wasn't the whole county. It would just be in the city or this little town where they would do the same thing and kick all the black people out. So minimum 260 times of this happening, a lot more than that most likely. And that's just focused on the U.S. You heard the caller from Canada dialing in and saying that they had the same thing that happened there. That's what I mean about collective white pathology and understanding what it means to be white, past, present, future. And the fact that white people are not honest about these events, and the fact that they use all sorts of deceptive deceitful language to obscure that this is terrorism, going in and killing these black people and stealing their property. And maybe this goes a long way to explain why black people don't have resources and wealth right now, because you have done such an efficient job pillaging and stealing from us for years and then lying about it and just saying, oh, you don't have anything because you're, you know, crackheads and all your children are teen pregnancies and all of that. If you would just pull your bootstraps up and pull your pants up, then things would be great. No, maybe if you would stop terrorizing us, maybe we could get ourselves together and be all right. At any rate, I wanted to share, when I went back and listened to that program with Elliot Jaspin, who is still a suspected racist, that's one thing that should not be glossed over at all. It is hugely important to have people like Mr. Everett doing these projects, because what you'll find consistently, I think this might even be the first time that we had a black person on the program who was heading up the project on one of these incidents of racial cleansings. Now, I know, I think it was a black person who did that film, Trouble Behind. I also think it was a black person, Marco Williams, who did the film Banished, which is on the same topic. But a lot of times it's white people who are the ones who are heading up, who become the quote unquote experts on these events. They're the person to go to if you want information. It was a white man, E.R. Bills, who did the book on the Slocum, Texas massacre. Same thing, where they went in and killed all these black people and kicked them out of the town and what have you. It was a white person. Elliot Jaspin did that book where he talks about what happened in Forsyth, Georgia and Indiana. Same story. He's a white person, though, who's in charge. There's a huge difference when you have a Christopher Everett, black person, who's telling the story and the words that they use, the way things get described, as opposed to a white person. Even when the white person has a lot of accurate information that they're bringing, they are still white. To that end, when Elliot Jaspin, he was on the program in 2010, his book, again, Buried in the Bitter Waters, he said that he was doing a news, he's a journalist, so he was doing a newspaper series on these racial cleansing. And I think he was, his newspaper series was focused specifically on Forsyth, Georgia. His book is about a myriad of these different events, some in Indiana, some in Georgia and other different places. But his newspaper series was just on Forsyth, Georgia. And he was, this was going to be published in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, which I think is the biggest paper in Atlanta and maybe that whole area of Georgia, and some of the other Cox publications. I think it's Cox, the Cox News Corporation that owns the AJC, and so his series was going to run in some other publications. He said Hank Klebanoff, this is a white guy, ended up fussing at him and saying that we're not going to put in racial cleansing, because that was the term he used, that we're not going to use that term, and that series never even ran in the AJC. It ran in some of the other publications, but it never ran in the AJC. And he said that it was Hank Klebanoff who ended up being in opposition to him and saying that I don't think we should use that word, and I don't know. They even at the AJC, they had another white man who posted a story and saying that, oh, this is a great mythology, and they just made all this stuff up about white people stealing black people's land in Forsyth, Georgia. None of this happened. There's no evidence of that. People just make up all kinds of things to try to blame us and say that we're racist and no good down here. None of that even happened. They did publish that. They did not publish in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. They did not publish Mr. Jaspin's series, and they in the publications where they did publish it, they refused to use the term racial cleansings, which is in the title of the book on this subject. And we talk about that on the program, where he said he felt that was the most accurate term to describe what happened. The thing that got me was Mr. Jaspin was on the program in 2010. Hank Klebanoff was on our program in 2013, and I just had forgotten that aspect of Mr. Jaspin's program, because that's kind of at the end. That's not, you know, the main thrust of what he's talking about. That's just an interesting aside that, okay, this also happened along the way. Mr. Klebanoff, he was on our program 3 years later in 2013 because he wrote a book with another white man, Gene Roberts. It's titled The Race Beat. Great information. It's basically about black journalism. We talked about that too today, but it's basically about the importance, the huge significance of black journalists in the 1940s, 1950s, 1960s period that they called so-called civil rights movement, and how they got out so much information that they were helping to push the momentum to get black people involved and doing what they could to fight against racism, because obviously the white press, they were not covering a lot of these different things that were happening, or they were doing standard racist operating procedure where they were being deceptive about it or not giving accurate information or what have you. Same thing that they do today when they report on things, and that's what their book is all about. Great information. That's what we talked about. And even with that, even though I wish I had known or remembered what Elliot Jaspin had said, even within that, on that program, you can hear where he's still a white person, and in my view, practicing white supremacy. That's what I expect them to do, and I think that came across, and he was with us in 2013. But man, I so wish that I had remembered what Elliot Jaspin and I talked about back in 2010, because I would have totally brought that up. You have written this whole book. You have all this extensive knowledge about racism, white supremacy, and the black press, and all the different things that they were reporting on and fighting against. But you have a white man who has done the research, went through the data, looked at the evidence, and is saying these are racial cleansings. That's what this is. How in the world can you come and tell him, oh, no, we're not going to publish that. There's no way we're going to put some story out talking about racial cleansings in Forsyth, Georgia. That's just ridiculous. We're not going to use that at all. He does that because that's what he's supposed to do. That's the system of white supremacy. And they won a Pulitzer. Mr. Klebanoff and this other white man, Gene Roberts, they won a Pulitzer for their book, The Race Beat, all this covering black journalists. Just, I cannot emphasize enough on people who've said on the program that black people reading is more important than watching television and writing. It is priceless to have black people being the ones who are telling these stories, whether you're writing books, articles, essays, documentary films, whatever it is that you can do, that cannot be overvalued. When you have white people telling these stories where they become the experts, this white woman, Jeanne Theo Harris, where she's like the expert, she's the go-to person for Rosa Parks, that happens over and over and over, where it ends up being some white person who is most likely a race soldier, I don't know how they wouldn't be, they end up being the person who is the expert, the supreme authority on this black person who worked against racism, their life and times, or a significant event involving black people, like what happened in Wilmington or what happened in Forsyth, Georgia, or any of these events. It ends up being white people, and they get to put their racist slant on how we understand history, how we understand pivotal, crucial events in the history of black people, history of racism, white supremacy. So it is extremely important that we have people like Mr. Everett and others who go out and do this work, black historians, black journalists, hugely important. That should motivate folks right there to turn off the television, turn off the video games or what have you, and do some research. And talking to, if you have older people in your family, if you have grandparents or great-grandparents, that those are tremendous assets. Really try to spend some time with them and see if they can tell you some of the things that they experienced, some of the things that they went through in their life. I mean, just invaluable information. And get a recorder. See if you can record it, because that way you can share that. You can share that with your children. When they talk about having difficulties, how do you explain racism, white supremacy to your children or grandchildren or younger black people that you're around? Man, let's go talk to grandma. Let's go talk to granddad. Let's go talk to, you know, aunts and uncles and some of the older people in your family, and just, you know, see if they can share some of this information. I think Isabel Wilkerson, great example right there, black person who gets to be the person who tells these stories, who tells this history, where she said she went and talked to some of these older black people who were in their 80s, 90s, talked about some of the things that they experienced in the early 1900s and different experiences and memories that they had about racism, white supremacy. And it was, I think, almost every person said that they had never talked about any of these things, that they hadn't told their children about them, hadn't told their grandchildren about them, that, you know, this is stuff that they hadn't thought about or talked about in 50, 60 years. Priceless information. That's the way that should be regarded. Priceless information. And I think that can go a long way, particularly for young people, to help them understand racism, white supremacy, what it is, how it works, and to help them understand why things are the way they are, why things look the way that they do now, why black people, the perception that they have of black people, how did it end up that way? the perception that they have of whites. How did it end up that way? Would, I mean, just a long way. I cannot encourage folks enough to do that type of work. You would probably be amazed at some of the stories that your grandparents, great-grandparents, aunts, uncles, even your parents, I suspect, depending on how old they are, you would be amazed, I can only say. And you would probably have a much greater appreciation for them, I suspect, once you get an opportunity to hear some of the things that they have experienced, some of the things that they have gone through, some of the things that they have endured to help take care of you. If we're talking about a parent, grandparent, aunt, uncle, someone who's probably played a role in your development and your life and helped you, you know, move along and get to where you are, to recognize, wow, these are some of the things that they had to go through and experience to help me get to this point. I will pause there. One of our listeners just wrote in to confirm once again, as Mr. Fuller states all the time, that whites, racists, they are masters of information and deception, I might add. I cannot emphasize that enough. You cannot be a master deceiver without having accurate information. This is not a case of white people just being confused or unaware, or they need to go see Mr. Everett's film. That's not my position at all. White people are very knowledgeable about these type of events, and I think you even heard him saying, Ken Chatfield, he was hearing his white relatives bragging, white people that he was around bragging about participating in this and how many niggers they killed and all the other things. This is standard. I've heard this over and over again, particularly when you're looking at these type of events, the racial cleansings. With that, I will pause there, make sure I didn't miss anything else. Okay, yeah, pause there. I think we nabbed everything. Anybody have anything quick that they wanted to get in before we wrap up, like a sentence? I'm going to try to recoup, so I'll be ready to roll tomorrow for our guest on the program. Thomas in New York, did you have a quick comment or question you wanted to make sure you got in, sir?
Yes, I do. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Good to hear from you.
Good to hear from you, too, and all the rest of the callers as well. What you were just talking about, do you think that our condition would be better if those stories of the acts of racism that happened to our grandparents and great-great-grandparents were passed down generation to generation to us?
I think so, and this is the logic. This is my reasoning for saying yes. I think you have so many black people, myself included, prior to, you know, getting a little bit more informed. What is racism? What it is, how it works, what does it mean to be white? I think you have so many black people who have just no information at all. Like, let's go to what we were talking about today with Wilmington. For black people in Wilmington, where they're saying that they didn't hear about this, even Mr. Everett saying that, you know, his parents didn't talk about this, his family didn't talk about this, no knowledge at all. I cannot imagine black people not making different choices. I'm not saying it would be a cure-all, but I'm saying I think we would have a much different understanding and appreciation for, number one, why we're in the position that we're in, and then when you have things that are current, that are happening right now, I think we would have a radically different interpretation of an event like what happened in Charleston, South Carolina with Dylan Storm Roof, if that information had been passed down, knowing the legacy of, this is just a continuation. This is the same thing that they did to granddad. This is the same thing that they did to grandma and blah, blah, blah. I mean, light years advanced if we had that information. When I look at a book like Isabel Wilkerson, The Warmth of Other Sun, and all of the things that she talks about where white people used to go to the black side of town and for fun would just go and shoot guns at black buildings and black people. This was just for kicks. We would go and do this. Having that information, I think, would give us a much more solid footing and grasp of what racism is, how it works, so it doesn't sound crazy when someone brings up this topic like, oh yeah, my family has told me about all of these different incidents. And even if it's not a grandparent or grandparent or someone who's telling you something that happened in the 1950s, 1940s, 1920s, even our parents, people that are not, you know, super, super old, but just talking about daily experiences of racism on the job. Oh, okay. So when this stuff starts happening to me, I get it. This is what I've been talking about. I'm prepared. I think it would radically improve our understanding and put us in a much better position in terms of making choices and just how we interpret the world in which we live. I think it would have a radical impact as opposed to having people growing up and not knowing any of this. And so they, you know, racism, that's just something in the past that didn't happen to anyone in my family. I don't know what you're talking about. Maybe that's Dr. King, Rosa Parks, and people that are dead, have been dead for a long time. That, you know, doesn't really have anything to do with me. I think it would quash a lot of that. I could be in error, but I just cannot imagine that. In fact, I look at white people when they say their grandparents and great-grandparents and dads and uncles, they're talking to them about racism from five. And so they get all this information from the cradle, and they get to evolve and develop with all that. The exact opposite happens with black people. I cannot think that if that was changed, I cannot come to any other conclusion that it would have a radical and constructive impact on our thought, speech, and action. I could be in error.
I agree completely. I took a different spin on it, but what you said was right on point, man. I was thinking there has to be a correlation between the words victims and victory, you know, and white people are definitely the victors, and they're also the victims and everything, and the fact that we don't victimize ourselves, it's always like we're afraid to be the victims. Like, yeah, this stuff happened to us. You know, if this stuff happened to white people, they'll be talking about it. I mean, look at the Jews, man. They don't let it ever forget it. They ain't going out to apologize, to accept an apology from the killing Ruth, you know, like the family members did from him. You know, then we're going to ride that hour. Then he came and shot us up in the church. I mean, they'll be crying about it till the day is done, you know. And we have to do that to ourselves, man. When this stuff happens to us, we got to make ourselves the victims.
I think it's just having an accurate understanding, because I think a lot of times when you don't have that information, I think the tendency, the momentum is we just blame ourselves. We just blame black people. That is something defective about us as to why we're in this predicament. If we, you know, didn't have our pants hanging off our behind, or if we went to school, or if we weren't on drugs, or if we weren't listening to hip hop and all this other nonsense. And no, white people, they have terrorized us. That's why we're in the position that we're, again, 260, multiply this by 260, the number of times. I just cannot imagine that not having a huge impact on our thinking and understanding. And I'm sure that white people understand that as well. That's why they don't have this information. That's why they don't teach this. That's why this information is not in schools, so that folks, everybody understands how this happened and how we ended up being in this position. I am certain that is exactly why that white people understand that, they know that, and that's why they generally make a lot of efforts so that you don't get that information. That's why that information wasn't in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. They don't want black people to have that information. It's much easier for black people to just blame themselves and each other as opposed to understanding that the culprits are white people. If anything, sharing this is just an indictment of white people. It's not anything to be ashamed about. It's certainly something to be angry about, and we should be. But if anything, it's just an indictment of white people. So we understand, oh, okay, this is who they were. This is who they are. This is who they're going to be. This is the continuum. This is what it means to be white. They cannot be redeemed. They cannot be changed. This is what they are devoted, committed to, the religion of white supremacy, terrorizing black people. I think it would fast forward our understanding tremendously, unless I'm in error.
Totally agree.
All right. On. The caller in Canada, did you have something you wanted to add in before we get ready to close things out?
Actually, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about, like, because I know, like, I agree with you on confusion, but what role do you think emotional conflict factors in? And this is part of my Canadian context, because, like I said, I think black people, specifically, at least in Toronto, are more, act just completely, I don't agree with the way they act in relative to other non-white people. For example, when I look at how we are very, for example, blacks here, like I live in a city where there's a heavy population of South Asian people, predominantly from India, and they will be extremely suspicious of these people. And they do have anti-black racism, like I'm not dismissing that. And I often wonder, why don't we ever have that for white people? Like I had a conversation once with a black gentleman once, and I can't remember what he was saying, you know, how Indians are ruining the economy because, you know, they think they're the superior race. And I brought up, you know, well, white people think that, and white people run Canada. I mean, Canada's majority white, right? And whenever I started bringing up how white people are the actual problems and cause income inequality and all these structural issues, you know his answers to me, Gus? People is people and fear is fear. Okay? That's the type of response I get, because see, Indians are Indians and a problem, but whenever you start to talk about white people, it becomes they want to embrace all people and not hate. So I often wonder sometimes, is it also just emotional conflict, just simply wanting to be accepted, regardless of whatever it takes or regardless of evidence to the contrary?
I think it just shows, my response would be, I think it just shows how effective racists, whites have been in terrorizing us. When you have a system of white supremacy and you can instill fear, when you have a system of white supremacy and you can instill fear and you're totally dominating another group and you have that group dependent on you for your livelihood, for your existence, where these folks can take you off the planet in a matter of seconds, or even if it's not that, they can be responsible for you not having employment, for you not having housing, for you not having food, anything, you not having education. I mean, you can run down all the areas of people activity. When you have people in that sort of condition, it has a huge impact on your willingness to indict these people, to talk bad about these people, to get on these folks' bad side. I think Mr. Everett, he had some people who were kind of saying, oh man, you don't want to bring that up. White people are going to get you. He said a few, not a whole lot, but he had a few people. I know I've experienced that myself, where people say the same thing. White people are going to get you. You don't want to upset them. They can do a lot of damage. So I think it just shows how successful whites have been in terms of conditioning us to not take that stance. Most of the time when they bring up racism, white supremacy, that gets stated, that, you know, we're not supposed to be angry with white people and we're all in this together and we want to hang out, we want to be around one another. That's what's going to solve the problem. If you even are sounding like you're saying, hey, wait a minute, these white people are aggressors, they're terrorists, they're racists, and they're not going to reform their behaviors. Whoa, wait a minute now. They almost start saying that you're a racist. They have done such a good, and I'm whites, they have done such a good job in terms of terrorizing us and then being in charge of the way that racism, white supremacy gets discussed. I think all of that works together with the fear, the confusion, the racist rhetoric in terms of how we're supposed to think about and talk about racism, white supremacy that produces that type of thinking. I think fear is huge in all of this, in not wanting to upset white folks. We know they can do a lot of damage. We might be confused about a lot of things, but I think most of us, the vast majority of us, we grasp white people can do a lot of damage in a short amount of time. It would be best to not get on that bad side. I think a lot of us, that's just the logic that we function with on a conscious, subconscious level. That is not in place for other non-white people. We don't have that same fear. We have not been terrorized to the same degree by anyone else on the planet. So I think a lot of that is just working together to produce those types of responses. And I think you start to move away from that when you start to get more accurate information about racism, white supremacy, and too, as black self-respect goes up, just being honest about what we're dealing with. I'm not saying this just because I want to sit here and spit vitriol about whites, just because it's accurate. The record shows, the record, the history of their conduct worldwide is the indictment. I don't have to say anything. We can just go to the history books and look at what they've done today, last year, Ben Tillman, Dylan Storm Roof. There's the indictment. That's just what it is. But that's my view. I could be in error, but definitely the fear, the confusion, the job that whites have done and having us in a position of domination, I think that all of that works together to produce those types of responses, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I agree, and if I could just add, you know, it's also the, you know, you could point out that it's white people, and black person's going to look at you and say, well, there's nothing we can do about that. You know, we might be able to do something about this Indian or this, even though there's really nothing we can do about that either, but in their mind, you know, it's we already going that route. That's not going to be a good route for us to go, you know, and we ought to have that automatically triggered into us from birth, I think, built into our records. And we already automatically know, let's leave those people alone because that's going to turn out tragic. Mm-hmm.
Right on. Might even can bring this up tomorrow because we should have a non-white, non-black person on the program to kind of hear her thoughts on all this. Again, I'll post the article if folks want to do some research in preparing for the program. But grand hearing from folks. Hope people will support Mr. Everett's documentary project. Fantastic film. When it is available for DVD, you should get a copy. If you are a North Carolina resident, or if you were raised in that area, if you have any connection to that area at all, it should be required viewing. And it's one of those, in my opinion, you should do some digging. It shouldn't just be you watch the film. You should try to get some of these documents, go to the website so you can see some of the reports that have been offered about this, because they go into some of the detail. Professor Darity in giving the economic impact of this and how this just devastated black people in Wilmington, and not just one generation, like for generations, devastated these black people in this area. It's just really, really important information that I would encourage folks to check out. And like I said, don't just watch the film. Go do a little bit of digging. You don't have to read every single document or read the entire 600-page report. Although, if you live in North Carolina, I think you should. As I said before, if you are North Carolina, if you're a black North Carolina resident, you should have a PhD on this subject. You should be very knowledgeable, so that anytime a white person tries to open their mouth and say something, give some lie about what happened, or give inaccurate information, bam, this is it. Boom, 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 boom. Source, documentary, the book, the film, set them straight immediately. You should be extremely knowledgeable, and then you can pass that information on to other family members, your children as well. But definitely support Mr. Everett, the film, Future Projects, DVD, and check out some of the additional information that's linked on the Facebook page and in the description for the program, where you can check out some of the other sources that have info on this subject matter. With that, we will catch folks in about 24 hours. Remain as safe as possible. If you have any questions, gripes, complaints, problems, feel free to drop an email, untiljustice@gmail.com. Untiljustice@gmail.com. I know one person, they emailed me during the broadcast where they were having problems listening online. I did check online today, and it was working for me. So if that happens, you can just drop me an email. You can try refreshing your browser. I know sometimes that happens where people just need to refresh their browser, and then it'll play if you're listening online. But I did check, and it was working for me. So hopefully folks didn't have any issues. It wasn't a widespread thing in terms of people having issues listening online. But feel free. Drop an email if you ever have problems, questions, guest suggestions, gripes, complaints. You can also hit us on Twitter @UntilJustice. @UntilJustice. Invest if you think the program is constructive. racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. Listener supported counter racist radio. PayPal button is in the top right corner. If you're not in the PayPal, just drop me an email and we'll get you a physical mailing address. That's it. Thanks again. I hope it was a constructive investment of your Monday evening. And we'll be back tomorrow evening, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. As always, sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. Can you imagine things break out November 10, 1898, if you're under the influence? How much worse that is going to make your situation and trying to escape and do the best you can to protect yourself and other black people that you care about. We are not in a safe environment anywhere in the world. If you are a black person, that should be kept in mind at all times. It's unfortunate. It's terrible that that's the way the world is, but that's what we have. And we should be doing everything that we can to try to change that. In that vein, definitely, if you're going to be in a vehicle as the driver, passenger, even as a pedestrian, you do not want to be under the influence of anything. You are just making the job of every race soldier, every Daniel Holtzclaw, every Darren Wilson, you're just making their job way easier to make all kinds of problems for you, even justify taking your life, raping you, whatever they want to do to you. Let's do everything we can to minimize contact with enforcement officers and not make it easy for them to come in and destroy our lives. I would encourage not being around whites who are under the influence. If they're intoxicated, that's a super dangerous environment anyway. Things can go from zero to lethal in the blink of an eye. I would also encourage I would be away from non-white people who are under the influence, because it's just too much evidence that we do not make wise choices under those type of situations. Things just get out of hand all the time, and we already got enough problems to deal with. We do not need any extra conflict in our lives as victims of racism. That said, buckle up every time you're in the vehicle. Again, minimizing contact with enforcement officers, and we will be back tomorrow. Creator, oh, make sure, again, Dr. Frances Cresswellsing, her sister, again, was having some medical issues. If it's not too much bother, if folks want to give a prayer or just a few thoughts for her speedy recovery. I know that's weighing heavily on Dr. Welsing right now, and she's been making trips to visit her sister. So folks that are out there, if that's not asking too much, if you want to give a prayer, whatever you do, just sending some good energy to her sister in Chicago. I'm sure she would appreciate it. That's it. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people. Victims of white supremacy, we ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Context of White Supremacy signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Yeah. I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.